tonight from Lexington, Kentucky. It is a top 10 showdown, game number two of the series between the number one Florida Gators and the ninth ranked Wildcats of Kentucky. A great crowd on hand once again tonight to see two of the top teams in college baseball. This is what's on the line. Florida number one with a bullet, and they're leading the East with a comfortable 3.5 game spread over Georgia. Kentucky trying to make up some ground. They need to win tonight if they want to win this series. Game number one went Florida's way, and it went that way early. The Gators got fantastic pitching from Brady Singer once again. He struck out 10 over 7 innings to earn the victory. Meanwhile, the offense helped them out in a big way. A 6-run third inning for Florida, highlighted by this Will Dalton home run, and the Gators put a pounding on Kentucky in game number one, an 11-2 final. And with that, we welcome to game number two on this Friday night in Lexington. Tom Hart alongside Chris Burke. What do we have for you tonight? Only one of the best pitching matchups that you will see all season. Guys that aren't just great college pitchers, but they should be great at the next level too.
Yeah, I think we got a couple big leaguers. This is a premium matchup in the Southeastern Conference. This is exactly what you're looking for if you're a college baseball fan. Jackson Coar, Sean Jelly, a couple first-round picks, a couple future big leaguers. Coar, they're doing a little different way. Coar will give you that swing and miss changeup, fastball command. He'll show you a breaking ball as well, but the changeup is the key pitch for him. Sean Jelly, the tallest pitcher in America. For him, it's about command and that breaking ball, a swing and miss breaking ball. So we got a couple guys here, Tommy, that can dominate the lineup. As you take a look at the numbers, both of these guys are pitching at a very high level. Coar with 6 wins already, Jelly with 5. The innings pitch, both these guys can be counted on as workhorses. Look at the walk numbers, though, from Jelly. Just 9 walks on the season and hasn't walked anybody in his last 4 starts. And there you get a look at the big right-hander. Elite stuff and Kamau, as we just said, has not walked anybody in his last 4 starts. Needs to go deep. Kentucky went with the bullpen last night for 7 innings, so he needs to be efficient and get deep into this ball game. And the breaking ball will be the key, not only for throwing it for a strike, but also swing and miss. You're going to have to punch out some of these Gators in some big spots because you know they're going to get runners on, Tommy.
So here's a look at the batting order put together by Kevin O'Sullivan, the defending national champs, feature the best player in the SEC. Jonathan India had his 24-game hit streak snapped last night, but he leads the league in batting average, on base percentage, slugging, walks, just about everything. And on top of that, the Gators hit their 60th home run of the season last night. They're now tied for the league lead in that category. Deacon Lippitt will lead things off. He had a couple of hits last night. So do you expect the Gators to try to take advantage of Jelly living in the strike zone?
He's going to swing at the first pitch.
Really?
Yeah, I thought he was. I think he was ready to.
I set you up for that.
He threw a ball. He was ready to swing at the first pitch.
Does it help as a hitter when you know a pitcher is going to be in and around the strike zone consistently?
I think it does. I think the challenge is when he's got 3-plus pitches. So, yeah, you know you're getting a strike. The question is which one of the three. And what you don't want to do is make a bunch of weak outs early. So there's a couple ways to look at it. Yeah, we're going to be aggressive, but what we don't want to do is look up in the 5th inning and he's got 40 pitches.
Yeah.
So it's a fine line with that.
He can certainly be efficient because he pitches to contact. And Lippitt hanging in there. Florida team, it's 5th in the SEC in batting average at .295. And as I said, now tied for the league lead in home runs.
One of the reasons I thought Lippitt would swing at the first pitch, and I think he would have had it been a strike. He's been struggling with punching out early in the ballgame.
Tristan Pompey handles it, one down.
And, you know, a new spot for him hitting leadoff this year. He did it a little bit last year. And sometimes as a leadoff hitter, you talk yourself into thinking you need to take too many pitches. So they're counting on him being a little more aggressive early in the ballgame.
So here's Nelson Maldonado now. Up the middle and a base hit for Maldonado. So now runner on for the most dangerous hitter in the SEC, Jonathan India.
We can talk a little bit later in this game about his mentality last night when he came to the plate with a 24-game hit streak on the line. It's something he hadn't felt in a long time. It was an 0-for-3 with a couple of walks. He was trying to catch up to the Florida record for consecutive games with a hit. Finished 6 games shy.
Anytime you go a month without going hitless, that's a nice month. 24 games, essentially a month plus without going over. It's probably an odd feeling for him to go to sleep last night knowing he didn't have a knock in the ball game.
So from the Palmetto State to the Bluegrass, this is SEC baseball, game number 2 of the series between number 1 Florida and 9th-ranked Kentucky. Tom Hart alongside Chris Burke. Happy to have you along tonight for this elite pitching matchup. The reigning SEC Pitcher of the Year, Sean Gelly, on the mound for Kentucky. And his counterpart tonight, Jackson Kowar, who's also a top major league prospect. Nelson Maldonado with a one-out single to get on base for Jonathan India, who has the inside track to be the SEC Player of the Year, leading the league in average, fourth in the league in home runs, and the league's best in on-base percentage and slugging.
Yeah, we got a couple of real dudes on the mound, and we got a mano-a-mano matchup early on in this ballgame. Jonathan India, without question, if the season was to end today, the conference's Player of the Year, and Sean Gelly, the reigning SEC Pitcher of the Year. We got ourselves a good one tonight.
Gelly has been sensational with his control over the course of the season. He's only walked 9 as they try to keep Maldonado near the bag. 4 stolen bases and 6 tries for the Florida base runner. Gelly has not walked a batter in his last 4 starts, covering 28 and a third innings. Of his 9 walks all season, 5 of them came in a single game against Arkansas. To third, chance for 2. Rodriguez to Becker. And safe at first is Jonathan India. Fantastic hustle by Jonathan India to beat the throw from Luke Becker.
Yeah, he can run. And I didn't think it was the cleanest turn by Kentucky. Didn't look like Rodriguez got a great grip. Becker certainly didn't get a good grip. And the speed of India just ahead of the throw from Becker. And that's, you know, it's certainly tight margins when you're trying to turn a double play, especially a 5-4-3. Kentucky misses an opportunity to get their star right-hander off the field early in the top of the first.
Twelve pitches thus far for Gelly. He has been so wildly consistent and efficient that he can go deep into games. And he's thrown a lot of innings already. He's only crossed the century mark once. That was 3 games ago at Alabama. He threw 103. But he only needed 93 pitches to go 7 innings against South Carolina. A breaking ball in there for a strike to Will Dalton, who's now leading the league in home runs with 14.
And there you see some of that elite command, just the ability to flip that breaking ball in there pretty much anytime he wants to. You'll see 2 different types of breaking balls, the roller early in the count and the sharp one for the swing and miss late. Such a weapon to be able to start a power hitter off like Dalton with a breaking ball for a strike. So breaking ball changeup back-to-back to start Dalton. We talked about that double play that they missed. When you miss a double play like that, especially with a guy like Dalton coming up, it's high-stress pitches right out of the gate for a guy like Gelly, because the league leader in home runs could put a 2-spot on the board in a heartbeat if you make a mistake.
That's what Dalton did in the 3rd inning last night. It was a 6-run frame on just 2 hits for Florida, and that essentially decided the game after the Gators were held hitless in the first 2 innings. So 1 ball and 1 strike to Will Dalton, sophomore from Spring Hill, Tennessee.
Came up and said to me that he grew up in Houston, Texas, and is a diehard Astros fan.
Wow.
Yeah. Moved to Tennessee at 8, but he spent the first 7 years of his life in Houston, Texas.
Did he tell you that he was allowed to stay up late enough to watch, say, I don't know, 18 innings of playoff baseball?
Well, funny you should say that. He actually started with it. He was at the game. And just for your memory bank, Tommy, that was a day game, so he didn't have to stay up that late. It was, I think, 12 o'clock Central start. So it was about 6 o'clock when that one ended. But, yeah, he was there. So that was a cool story. I always appreciate when these young men come up and introduce themselves and tell you their story a little bit.
He's not the only really good baseball player that was there that day. Wasn't Boomer White, the former SEC Player of the Year, also at that game?
I think that's right.
That was NLDS game number 4 against the Braves in 2005.
So we had two things in common. Then he grew up in Tennessee and was, he said his whole family are diehard Vol fans, but did not receive an offer from the University of Tennessee.
Wow.
Yeah, either out of high school or junior college.
Runner goes, pitches, hammer foul. That's really interesting. You know, Dalton put on a lot of weight over the last couple of years and turned into a power threat. Junior college, he had 15 home runs, most in the BB Corps era. Was a first-team All-American. But a senior of high school, he only hit 3 home runs, and only 2 his junior year. So he has grown into a power hitter in a lot of different ways. Not just the approach, but also with the body and the strength.
Well, and you mentioned the strength, and of course you got to have the mechanics to go along with the strength. And he gives Matt Pierce, a hitting guru down in the Houston, Texas area, a lot of credit for teaching him about how to get ready, how to move the bat through the hitting zone, how to create consistent ball flight and get good spin on the ball. And, you know, I think the power was there his senior year, but the path maybe didn't match the power, and now he's put them both together. Started last year in junior college where he hit 20 home runs there. So, you know, the fact that he's been able to hop right into this league and produce at what he's on pace to hit 20 in this league shows you the type of talent he has. And they got him for 2 years. It's not a junior college transfer that they get for one. He's a sophomore, so they'll get him for one more.
29th round pick of the Orioles coming out of high school. Runner goes. The throw down is wide, and it kicks into shallow right field. India with his 9th stolen base in the season. Troy Squires behind the plate has only thrown out 1 out of 13. What did India take to the face? Was that a foot, maybe?
You know you're probably getting a breaking ball right here. Decent jump, not a great jump, but again, India can really run. He was out, though. I think if Luke Becker makes that catch, the throw had him beat. But Becker kind of in a rush to make the tag, doesn't finish the catch. I think he got a little dirt in his eyes. I think maybe up his nose. I don't know. But he could have easily advanced to third base. Looks like maybe up his nose.
Get him one of those plungers. So in scoring position for Dalton, but then again, he probably was when he was at first. 2-2 now.
Now you think about it. I know this. I've brought it this the second time. I'll bring it up again. They weren't able to turn the double play.
Yep.
And now they don't catch the caught stealing. And neither one of those go as errors, but two different defensive plays that could have had your big right-hander sitting on the bench drinking Gatorade right now.
Swing and a miss for Dalton. And so Jelly able to get out of any sort of trouble and striking out the best power hitter in the SEC. We'll see Kentucky's offense next. All right, Schick, thanks. Great to have you aboard. Chuck will try to drive in a run and then maybe get the save tonight for the Bulldogs. They're having a remarkable season in the Classic City. Here's a look at Kentucky's batting order. They came into this weekend one of the top teams in the country, in batting average and home runs, but they have been struggling lately. Just a 115 average as a team over the last 2 games. Luke Heyer, one of a handful of guys at the top of the lineup. Their top 3 hitters last night went 0 for 11 with 6 Ks. Heyer leading the league in runs driven in. Kentucky team that likes to score some runs. They're loaded with junior college transfers. But they get to face one of the top pitchers in college baseball. As we said of Jelly before, this is Jackson Kowal.
and swing and miss stuff. The changeup is especially the pitch to watch. If he gets that going, he can be dominant, over 60% swing and miss rate on his changeup. And, Tommy, this is a big money start for Jackson Carr and Sean Jelly. There are a lot of decision makers in the crowd tonight. From a scouting standpoint, he got a chance to make himself a lot of money here tonight.
See the radar guns pop up right behind the plate. Kowar is 6-1 with a 2.70 ERA as he makes his 10th start of the season. He has struck out 54 in 56 and two-thirds. Tristan Pompey is the leadoff hitter for Kentucky, switch hitter. He, too, is a top prospect. And he ropes one to the gap in right center field. It'll get to the fence on two hops. Pompey lumbers around first, and he's in with a leadoff double.
That's what they're looking for. The home crowd fired up. This offense makes its living on extra base hits. How about a fastball down? Oh, a changeup. Had good depth, but kind of middle, and Pompey does a nice job of getting down there with that baseball and ripping it into right center field. And here come the Cats trying to get off to a better start than they were able to yesterday.
We saw a lot of changeups last night from Florida's Brady Singer, and one of the reasons he threw so many is his Florida coaching staff wanted to see how Kentucky would react to it, because Kowar relies heavily on his changeup. Squires will drop down a bunt. J.J. Schwartz from behind the plate, and the sacrifice moves Pompey 90 feet closer.
You know, changeup pitcher, left-handed hitter, first inning, senior, you would think they'd give him at least a shot to swing the bat and move the runner over via the swing and try to drive him in and get him over maybe. But Kentucky really playing conservative here in the first, trying to make sure they get this first run on the board.
That brings Luke Becker to the plate. Becker, one of three Minnesotans on this Kentucky roster, including their starting pitcher, Jelly. And a breaking ball misses at the shoe tops. Do you think the consideration is that we're facing a guy in Kowar who's practically unbeatable?
Yes, I think they want their guy to get to pitch with a lead, and I think they were trying to eliminate all variables there and just get the bunt down. Squires handles the bat very well. I think you could probably count on him to get that job done however you'd like. In the first, with a left-handed hitter, I would probably be more apt to let him swing the bat. But beautiful job of getting that bunt down and obviously playing for that first run here in the top of the bottom of the first.
Becker had a couple of hits last night. He was 2-for-3. And Kowar is behind in the count, now 3-0 after missing with the fastball. Becker came to Kentucky by way of Northern Iowa Community College. He's got five home runs in the season, including a home run against South Carolina on his birthday. And he draws a one-out walk.
He didn't look like he wanted any part of Luke Becker right there. Becker with a couple knocks off Singer last night. First base open, the righty on deck. Set yourself up a double play opportunity. Sully doesn't look too happy about it, but of course he never looks all that happy, does he?
He looks a little chilly is what he looks. National championship last year for Kevin O'Sullivan. And another first-round pick in Alex Fiedo. Well, Kentucky failed to get a double play turned in the first inning. Florida is really good at that. In fact, once again, they're one of the better fielding teams in the SEC. A great article today, Berkey. I know you like the analytics. The Athletic had an article about the top teams in Major League Baseball, written by Mark Simon, and he said one of the barometers that you can simply look at is turning ground balls into outs. It's the biggest thing. Yeah, more balls are hit in the air these days, but you've got to be able to field it. You've got to get outs on the ground. Double plays, obviously, even better.
Because you get two.
Yeah, it's simple math, really.
That makes it important.
In 2016, eight of the top 11 teams in turning ground balls into outs, including bunts, made the postseason, including the Cubs, who were number one in Major League Baseball. They won it all by beating the Indians, who were number two.
That's more than coincidental information right there. I think there's
a lot of truth in that. And we see Florida and LSU year in and year out are at the top of this league, and year in and year out seem to be national seeds and hosting regionals and super regionals, and they are always at the top of this league in defense.
You can go bigger picture than that. Teams throughout the country that we saw make it to Omaha last year. It's Kevin O'Sullivan's going to have an early visit to Mount. Teams like Louisville and Oregon State.
TCU.
Yep.
Yeah, I mean, really, if you want the probably the top two indicators of Omaha-caliber teams is probably fielding percentage and ERA.
And they are obviously related.
They are very closely related, and that would spell trouble for Kentucky.
Yes.
When you look at their bulk numbers, both pitching and defensively.
So from a big picture standpoint, D1 Baseball has its latest projections for the postseason, and these are their top eight seeds in order. You've got a handful from the SEC. Texas Tech beat Oklahoma today already. They're having a remarkable season. They'll be in Arkansas midweek. They got a Wednesday game between Texas Tech and Arkansas on the SEC network. That'll be a big one.
I think those first five there are slam dunks. There's a lot left to be said there in the last three spots. Probably East Carolina is probably the one that's, I feel, most certain would remain. And that doesn't mean NC State and Ole Miss won't be there, but boy, they got a lot of big games left, those two clubs.
2-1 pitch to Cottom is up and in. What do you think the message was from Kevin O'Sullivan?
Challenge. Challenge. Don't worry about a run. Like, let's trust your stuff. And I like the game plan. Cottom wants the ball down. He wants it away. You got to really trust your stuff here and trust that fastball velocity and command on the inside part of the plate. I think they're going back in there again.
Chopped off the plate. Chance for two. Kick of the bag and a throw over. Got him. It's Blake Reese turning two all by himself. And Florida gets the big double play when they need it.
And there it is, Tommy. Florida's defense, the execution. First of all, you got to get the ball up and in. The umpires are going to take a look at this one. But Blake Reese decides late that he's going to catch it out at second for sure. I think he's out at first too, Tommy. A big play in this ball game. He's out at second. Ooh, that's close at first base. I definitely think that's close enough to review, especially with a run on the line. But I like how quickly the crew decided to challenge that one. They didn't even wait for Nick Mangione to come out. I think he beat it. Looking at it again, I think
Jason Millsap is the first base umpire.
No, I think that's going to stand. I think it's going to stand. How many times can I change my mind? I've gone out, safe out. I'm going to stay without.
Does Brady Smith keep his foot on the back?
Foot is on the base. Brady Smith still learning how to play first base. He didn't do a great job there with where his inside foot is, but I think that call will stand.
This play is being reviewed. Call on the field was out.
But again, back to our conversation. Turning ground balls into outs, not just one, but two. And that was one where it was pretty awkward. Lippitt and Reese weren't sure who was going to take it. Reese decides late he's the guy, and that's going to stand.
Must be, you may have heard this phrase before, it must be indisputable video evidence.
I have.
Umpires back around the corner taking a look at this one. Within conference play and in the SEC tournament, force plays are reviewable. They are not reviewable otherwise during the course of the season. David Brown is our home plate umpire.
Huge call in the game right here.
And there it is. So it's a double play to close the frame. You know what I'm wondering? I wonder what Matt Schick thinks about that. Welcome back to Lexington after the review. Ready to go in the top of the second inning. J.J. Schwartz will lead off for Florida. Seniors hitting just under 300 on the season with 9 home runs. And he laces one to right field. Over to get it is Luke Heyer. Schwartz looking for two.
Hey,
Heyer's throw is a little bit late. It's a leadoff double for J.J. Schwartz.
How about J.J. with a leg double? We were having a conversation before the game today about how he just feels like he is letting the ball get deeper. He's felt so much more comfortable with his contact point all year long. Does a really nice job of letting that ball travel, keeping his nose down, and ripping that ball over Cottom's head. And I love the aggressive play to get to second base with nobody out. Great time to take that chance. And Gators got a chance to now strike first after it looked like the Cats were a sure bet last inning.
Here's Austin Langworthy at the plate for Florida. He's from Williston, Florida, just down the road from Gainesville.
Couple different approaches here, Tom. It looks like two outs, nobody on. Maybe the Gators are going to let the lefty swing the bat. They are not. Florida is not a team that sack bunts much. Just five on the year coming into the ball game.
I had a long talk with Sully about that earlier this season, and he said, listen, we work on bunting every day, every single day. You know, they have the pitching machine out, especially when they're at home, and we know it's important. He goes, but the bottom line is, I got a bunch of dudes who have never bunted before. J.J. lost his shoe, so good luck untying the knot with batting gloves on. He says, forget it. I'm just going to shove my foot in here.
There you go.
You get it in?
He's good.
He said, I can't get it untied because I'm wearing batting gloves. You don't think he's catching some grief from the dugout, do you? And Sully's point when it comes to bunting, among other things, is that that's a skill. And here it is. Langworthy's going to drop it down. Jelly has to hurry. And we've seen a sack from each side here in the early going.
Well, just the sixth on the year, and that could have come from Langworthy. He might have, you know, some teams will give a hitter the option. Hey, look, whatever you feel most comfortable.
Schwartz is still efforting
to get the knot out. But Langworthy might have done that on his own.
Here we go. It helps when you don't have the gloves on, and he took them off right before the pitch.
And I was a guy, whenever I got the option, I always felt more comfortable. I wanted to make sure I got the guy over, and as a right-handed hitter, I always felt like it was much more difficult for me to get that surefire ground ball to second base than it was for a lefty. So I always used that as an opportunity to kind of bunt for a hit. And I think Langworthy did kind of the same thing there.
Brady Smith homered last night. Getting a start at first base tonight, hitting the 7-hole. But to finish the thought,
yeah,
one of Sully's points was these guys spend all offseason playing travel ball and go through the various circuits. And Smith rides this one straightaway center. Ben Eklinski hauls it in for out number two. And Schwartz is going to come home on a sack fly. He said, you know, it's pretty simple. It's not like there's a whole lot of bunting in the summertime.
Right. No, and all these kids were the best hitter on their high school team. So very few of them have been called. And, you know, bunting's one of those skills similar to free throw shooting that, you know, everybody feels like everybody should be good at it. But the reality is there's very few that are great at it. And usually when you're called on to bunt, it's one of those pressure kind of moments that sometimes can get away from you. So if you don't have a lot of experience with it, it can be much more difficult than it looks. But Langworthy gets his job done. The freshman, Brady Smith, with a nice piece of hitting on a deep fly ball to center field. And just like that, the Gators actually score first. Beautiful baseball. Double, get them over, get them in.
Jelly comes inside that time. A little bit against the scouting report. The Florida guys were convinced that Jelly likes to work away no matter what side you bat.
Yeah, and we saw into Lippitt, and now we're seeing into Reese.
And he goes with a wipeout breaking ball for his second K. He is ended work. I'll be in Fayetteville for number 5 Texas Tech and number 3 Arkansas in a midweek 2-game series at Baum Stadium. That's 7 Eastern, 6 Central, also streaming live on the ESPN app. Arkansas loves the analytics. Their pitching coach, Wes Johnson, does a sensational job in his little laboratory trying to figure out what everything means and how to get good use of it. And he's not alone in the game, whether it's pitching or hitting. And we had a chance, thanks to the guys at TrackMan, to break down some of these Kentucky swings. And we'll bring you some of that information throughout the game tonight as Luke Heyer singles to right field. We'll start with Heyer. Are you going to hit today?
I'd like to see what the exit velo was on that bullet. We get one on a homer right here. The barrel on plane with the baseball. Got to get the barrel behind and below the baseball, then work up through it. TrackMan gives us these numbers, 106 miles per hour exit velo, a launch of 27 degrees. When you get the bat on plane with the ball and move through it, you got a chance to hit the ball out of the ballpark. 106 miles per hour is over the major league average, which is about 104. And that 27 degrees of launch is about perfect. 28 degrees, they say, is the absolute optimal launch off the bat to get the ball out of the ballpark. But when you've got world-class exit velo like Luke Heyer does at 106, you can get the ball out of the ballpark at a lower launch. But there's a few guys on this Kentucky team that can really move the baseball. Luke Heyer is certainly one of them.
One on for Ben Eklinski, who was 1-for-4 last night. Speaking of Arkansas, by the way, they're not wasting any time. India backhand knocks it down. Too late. And everybody's safe. Base hit for Eklinski, two on. Arkansas leads 4-0 against Mississippi State. Here's the spray chart according to TrackMan for Luke Heyer.
Yeah, so these are just home field home runs. So you see there, 6 to the pull side, 2 to the right center gap. His max exit velo is 106. His average is 104, which is right on par with the major league average. Now, he's using an aluminum bat, and the big boys are using the wood. But BB Correa, those numbers are pretty similar. And so Luke Heyer is moving the baseball at a major league elite level, along with a couple other guys, as I said earlier, in this Kentucky lineup. But that's one of the reasons he finds himself atop of a lot of the Southeastern Conference slugging statistics.
Ryan Shin squares early. Bunch popped up foul. Shin making his 12th start of the season from Jobstown, New Jersey. So how do hitters use those numbers these days to their advantage?
Well, I think the best time to do it is in the offseason. So many of these clubs will use HitTrax or TrackMan to help these hitters understand what their ball flight is, what their exit velocity is, and what their optimal numbers are relative to their exit velo. It starts with that, right? So if you don't move the ball fast enough, then you're not going to be a guy who's looking to create a higher launch, right? But if you can get it up over 100 miles an hour, well, now you get a chance to get the ball out of the park consistently if you can get the launch up over 20 degrees. So now if you're a guy that lives in the low to mid-90s, you're going to work on a ball flight that's a much flatter ball flight, live in that 10 to 15 degree with your work. But once you realize, hey, I can move the ball at 100, 105, 110 miles an hour, now it's time to get the ball in the air.
Shin squares with two strikes. And he gets it down. He'll advance both runners. Good piece of bunting by Ryan Shin after he fouled off the first two. TrackMan home run analytics.
Yeah, so there's a lot to digest here, but Pompey, the exit velocity at 107, Collette 106, Heyer 103, Cottom 103. That's their average exit velocity on home runs. You see the MLB average there, just under 105. Their launch angles, Pompey 20, Collette 31, Heyer 27, Cottom 28. So for me, Tommy, when I look at that numbers, Pompey's hitting it the fastest, but his launch is the lowest.
Alex Rodriguez hit the plate with two and scores.
So you say, how do you use those numbers? Hey, Tristan, we need to get the ball up in the air a little bit more, right? And he weighs in at only 5 home runs, yet Cottom and Heyer have 13, almost 3 times as many homers because they're consistently getting the ball in the air with more carry, more launch.
Alex Rodriguez in the 8th with one out here in the second. Does that make a scout's job easier? Does that make a hitter more projectable at the next level?
I think if I was a scout, and I know all these major league teams subscribe to TrackMan, they would be able to use that data in a meaningful way. And when you see that Tristan Pompey, we showed you his average home run exit velo, which is 107, but his average exit velo just in general is over 100, which puts him at the top of all major league of all major league players. So, yes, I mean, if I'm a big league team and I say, wow, here's a guy that moves the ball at that kind of level, we can work on the path to create a little bit better launch, but tougher to teach the exit velo piece than it is the launch angle piece.
And the exit velocity is coming from being a quick twitch athlete with strength. I mean, is it no doubt. That simple?
Yeah, and the mechanics are working in such a way. Plus, you got to compress the ball. Like, you got to hit it square. So there's a hand-eye coordination element to it, too.
Big pitch. Swing and a miss. Back-to-back breaking balls. And Alex Rodriguez goes down swinging. Two down here. Let's find out what's going on with Arkansas. Here's Matt Schick. Like Greg McElroy, the pride of South Lake Carroll High School, Eric Cole.
Well, that's a talented offense. There are so many dudes in that lineup that can beat you on any given night. You come in thinking maybe Kerstad or Martin or Bonfield or Shaddy, and Eric Cole can get you in a heartbeat. You get Blaine Knight 4 runs. I like the Razorbacks' chances. How about in this ball game? We've already had some situational hitting. We saw Florida driving the run with the sack fly. Kentucky's had 2 chances with a runner at third and less than 2 outs and have hit into a double play and a strikeout.
Trey Dawson from Hurricane, West Virginia, batting in the 9 hole. By the way, Kentucky's worst series of the season may have been their trip to Fayetteville. They got swept. Cole, who you just saw hit that grand slam, Rob Troy Squires of a home run to lead off the series in the very first pitch, and then opposite field home run in the bottom of the first. And I don't know that Arkansas ever trailed in that entire series.
Now, that's a big reason why Kentucky is last place in the league in ERA, because of that series where Arkansas just absolutely put it on them.
.39 runs and 13 home runs hit by Arkansas in their sweep over Kentucky. Outscored the Cats 39-15. It was Arkansas's most runs in a 3-game SEC series since 1997. That's amazing.
Yeah, that was just fast break offense all weekend by Arkansas. They seemed like they were coming out of the gates right out of the chute, blazing each game. And really, you know, for Kentucky, the series at Arkansas and the series at Alabama is why their record is under 500. This isn't a team you would ever think would get swept, and certainly a series at Alabama you would expect them to win. But they lost the series at Alabama 2-1 and got swept at Arkansas, and that's why they find themselves sitting at 7-9 right now instead of at least 9-7.
Ground ball. And Florida is going to turn that ground ball into an out. After consecutive singles to start the inning, Coar gets 3 straight outs. We are through with 2, and number one Florida leading 1-0. Coar going against Sean Jelly. This is a big-time pitching matchup here tonight. And with us tonight, back in the studio, we have number one overall pick, Ben McDonald, who's listening in and watching. This is Sean Jelly, who's thrown 30 pitches thus far, going to work against Nick Horvath. Hey, Ben, I'm curious. Did you ever have a start? First, I was curious if you could hear me. Then I had that question answered. You were the number one pitcher in the country your junior year at LSU. Did you have games where you went head-to-head with another guy of your caliber that got you up for the game, knowing that guy I'm throwing against tonight is going to give me a test and this is going to be a big-time pitching matchup?
Ben, we heard Tom talk about there was 50-plus scouts here last night, just as many here tonight. We got 2 first-rounders on the mound. We know that the decision-makers can only get to so many games throughout the course of the year. There are a number of big-time decision-makers in the house here tonight. I was just curious, as you were going through your junior year, was there a start you made where you kind of felt like, man, this one really matters as far as a draft perspective, or did you try to just kind of block that out with each start?
Did that bring pressure with it? Not the pressure to be the number one overall pick, but knowing that there was, as Berkey says, a lot of heat in the stands, knowing there are a lot of big-time decision makers watching you throw that day? That's a first walk, by the way, from Sean Jelly in more than four games. Go ahead, Bert.
Yeah, and that's a rare sight. What, break down Sean Jelly. What do you like about him? Yeah.
Top of the order now for Florida, and Deacon Lippitt at the plate. So if you're coaching a young pitcher who is tall, is similar size to either you or Jelly, do you encourage them to simplify their mechanics, or what makes it more easy to repeat? Hey, Ben, before we let you go, runner goes on a pitch in the dirt, and safe at second is Horvath. Before we let you go, and we appreciate you joining us, who picked out your tie tonight? It's great. We look forward to seeing more of it throughout the game and then afterwards on SEC Now. Thanks for your time, pal. Big Ben McDonald, number one overall pick. Olympic gold medal.
He didn't really answer the question. He said it was for you, but he didn't say who picked it out.
He did not. Maybe it was his dog, Jeter.
Maybe.
Swing and a miss for Lippitt. Sean Jelly seems to be one of those pitchers, Berkey, that when he needs a pitch, can deliver it.
Well, and there you see the breaking ball command. Again, he can throw it for a strike whenever he needs to, but he can also get the swing and miss and throws that one right to the back edge of home plate. And Lippitt thinks he's got a pitch he can maybe rip in the four hole, and instead comes up empty. And a big strikeout right there as he keeps that runner at second base and gets his first out of this inning.
Two-hole hitter Nelson Maldonado.
It is remarkable when you look at Jelly's command relative. You know, it took Randy Johnson until he was about 25 years old before he even really had any kind of clue where the baseball was going. Now, Randy Johnson was 97 to 100, and Jelly's not
not pitching at that level of velocity, but when you think about the command and the coordination of this athlete, it is awfully impressive.
Ben McDonald played basketball for Dale Brown.
Yeah.
Almost went to the Final Four. Could have been a punter on the LSU football team.
I don't doubt it. Probably could have been a high hurdler or a high jumper. I mean, he probably could have done whatever he wanted. But, yeah, when he thinks you're a really good athlete, that's saying something.
Yeah.
And that's the one that separates him. 2-0 count. Maldonado thinks he's going to get a heater, and Jelly just really at will looks like he can flip that breaking ball in for a strike. Now, Maldonado will give it to you 2-0. If he throws it again, if he throws that spinner right down Broadway on 2-1, he might get his feelings hurt. But a nice pitch to steal a strike there in a 2-0 count.
Out of play. I want to go back to something we were talking about earlier with Ben. In Major League scouts, that's a pretty catch-all term. Like, they show up to a lot of Friday night games.
Right.
But some of the faces and names that you recognize were more than just the local guy who's out here every Friday, not to take anything away from that position.
Well, everybody has their area scouts, and they are following the premium arms on a weekly basis. But the decision makers, the national cross checkers, the assistant GMs, they can only get to so many places a season. So they have to prioritize when they're going to go watch everybody that's in what they believe to be their draft range, right? And so when you get a chance to see two, like, if you're picking in the first 20 picks in the Major League Draft right now, you have two guys pitching tonight that could fall in your lap. So if you were, you know, assistant GM, a GM, or certainly a national cross-checker, you are prioritizing this ball game to get to because you can kill two birds with one stone. So it is a big start for both of these young men in this ball game.
The Detroit Tigers have their number one overall pick. MLB draft starts on June 4th. By the way, the value of that number one overall pick is over $8 million. It goes Tigers, Giants, Phillies, White Sox, Reds, top five picks.
You know, I would say there's probably only two starts these kids know that big-time decision makers are at, and that would be this one and Hoover for the SEC tournament.
Yeah.
And you know all the heat is in Hoover.
Two walks from Sean Jelly in this inning. He hadn't walked a batter in his previous four starts. In fact, he hadn't walked one in his last 30 and a third.
Well, and that's what this lineup will make you do, similar to the five walks against Arkansas. You're going to rethink some of your strategy and try to be a little bit finer when there is this many hitters that can hurt you. And we talk about the heat in the building being here to see the pitchers, Tom. They're also here to see this hitter right here in Jonathan India, because he is flying up the draft boards, as you like to say, straight helium in the draft throughout the course of this season, because he might be the first college position player taken. So there's a lot of eyeballs on him tonight as well.
He's 0 for 1 tonight. He went 0 for last night. That snapped a 24-game hit streak. We talked to him about it before the game today, and he admitted, yeah, of course I'm thinking about it. You know, I come to the plate my last time up. I know it's my last chance, but I also don't want to go 0 for 4.
That's right.
Ended up drawing a walk. It might have been a pitch or two he could have swung at during that at-bat.
And he told us he was ready. He just didn't like the 3-0 offering, which was called a strike, and the 3-1 pitch wasn't close.
What do you like about Jonathan India as a thinker of the game? You've talked a lot of baseball with him, and it's, you know, he seems to have a good feel for the game.
Yeah, and like you see a take right there, he just has slowed everything down. It, there's still beautiful rhythm to his movements and his body patterns, but it's really under control, and he has slowed everything down, and it's showing up in his pitch recognition. And this is about as good as it gets here, Tom. You get the reigning SEC pitcher of the year pitching against what is probably going to be the SEC hitter and player of the year in a 1-0 ball game with a runner in scoring position. And you're learning a lot about what Sean Jelly wants to get him out with as he starts this at bat off with breaking ball. And I think at some point you can't be predictable with a hitter like India. You're going to have to speed him up right here. Does he trust himself to run one in on India? You got to be careful throwing anything out over the plate right now to the red-hot India.
Jelly as a whole is a guy that likes to work the outer third of the plate as opposed to inside.
Yeah, again, in this ballgame, we haven't really seen him throw one into righties. He'll throw it to inside the lefties, which is his glove side, but we haven't seen him throw a lot of arm side fastballs in a 1-2 count. Well, after three breaking balls, you'd think he'd have some room to try to crowd India right here with a good heater.
Two on for the league's best hitter, Jonathan India. Another breaking ball.
Four in a row. I think that 1-2 pitch is a great time to move his feet. Move his feet, throw it right at his knees, and then go back to that breaking ball. I just don't think you're going to get a chase out of this kind of hitter after you've thrown him three in a row.
Time called, and Troy Squires is going to go have a word with him. We talked about that earlier today, in fact, during Florida's batting practice, about being the kind of pitcher that will throw a fastball even if you're not throwing it for a strike.
That's right. Yeah, and this is one of those opportunities. You have to at least speed him up a little bit. Make him think that you want to get him out in and go back to your bread and butter, but you just stick with the breaking ball, and at this point, you're not giving yourself a lot of margin for error.
Here's the 2-2 pitch.
There you go.
And then fouled him off. Florida uses a scouting service called Synergy. It's very popular in the basketball world. It's coming along now on the baseball side as well. And they broke down in the scouting report Sean Jelly's propensity and percentages of throwing fastballs versus other pitches. The average is somewhere north of 60%. Jelly's more 50-50 fastball breaking.
Yeah, he's closer to 50-50. I think it was 54 or 56% fastball. So they know they're going to get a lot of breaking balls from Jelly. And he got around that one. We talked about what a great offense will make you do. This is an elite command pitcher, and you're seeing him struggle with his command, and it's more about who's in the batter's box than it is about him not feeling great. He knows who's up to bat, and he knows what's on the line, and he just doesn't want to make a mistake, and that sometimes can cause you to get a little big with that breaking ball.
Here's the payoff to Jonathan India. And he misses upstairs, and Sean Jelly has walked the bases loaded. He had only walked 9 all season long, and he's walked 3 here in this third inning.
So he's got 12 walks, and 8 of them are against Arkansas and Florida.
Your two best hitting teams in the league.
And this is definitely a time for a meeting at the mound from Jimmy Bellinger, the pitching coach. And you got to go out there and talk to your right-hander and try to convince him that he doesn't have to be as fine as he is attempting to be at this point in the ballgame.
Well, the danger with that, since you're a little bit late, with that message to really get it across, is now if you're going to challenge Will Dalton, you have the top home run hitter in the league, and oh, by the way, the bases are loaded. Like, now you really can't afford to make a mistake.
No, but the stuff is good enough, and the angle, as Ben was talking about earlier, the angle on the fastball and the ability to get the two-seamer down in the zone. Yes, if you leave it up and leave it out over the plate, Will Dalton can launch you in a heartbeat like we saw the 3-run homer last night. But you know he's swinging. So, again, do you believe in your stuff? You know he's ready to hit. You've just walked the bases loaded. He's going to try to ambush a first-pitch fastball. Do you believe in your stuff? Do you believe in your ability to execute a sinker down in the zone? If so, you might get yourself a 6-4-3 and walk off the field.
Is there a chance that they put in a pickoff play here somewhere to try and steal one?
There's a chance. Absolutely. I wouldn't put that past Kentucky by any means. But my guess is most of that conversation was centered around execution and how they were going to get themselves out of this mess that their star right-hander has created.
So here's Will Dalton, 14 home runs, leading the league. And he almost took out his teammate Horvath. Man.
And that's what it looks like when you're sitting on a breaking ball. So Kevin O'Sullivan comes out of the dugout. Him and Will Dalton had a meeting. You see Dalton very frustrated with himself because that's sitting on a breaking ball. Almost killed his partner, Will Horvath. And if he lets that travel an extra foot, it's 3-0 on a 3 or 4-0 because that would have been a double in the left field corner. That's a good pitch. And I would throw that at least one, if not two more times, because he certainly showed you he's sitting on a breaking ball, at least on that first pitch for sure.
Will Dalton is tied for third in the country in home runs. He's behind Spencer Torkelson of Arizona State and Andrew Vaughn of Cal. Dalton's going to have to lip that one off.
I mean, that one was no fun. He missed a really good pitch to hit here. They're trying to go down and in with a sinker, and this one is right down Broadway. And Dalton just comes over the top of it. One of the things you'll see with his bat path is he's definitely looking to launch the ball in the air. And with that, sometimes he'll come over top of the ball and hit some of those big top spinners, or in this case, really miss hit one right off his ankle. But a little flatter path right there, and this game would be 5-0.
John Michelini is the Florida athletic trainer. Florida's hit a pair of grand slams this season. Jonathan India has one. Nelson Maldonado has the other.
This was always one of those situations as a hitter where you're really in your own head. You're like, okay, I just fouled a sinker off my ankle. Is he going to throw it in there again? Or is this where he's going to try to get me to chase a breaking ball away because I'm a little sensitive to being jammed here? My guess is with Jelly and trusting his breaking balls, he's going to go with the breaking ball down and away right here, try to get a punch out.
Base is loaded for the Gators, and Will Dalton. And he rips this one to center. It'll push Eklinski back, and it's over his head. Horvath has scored. Maldonado coming home. India on his heels. And safe at third with a three-run triple is Will Dalton.
Well, the ankle must not be bothering him too much, Tommy, because he was flying around the bases. And again, you got two choices right there. Do you try to go back to the sinker, go with the breaking ball? They choose the sinker, and that's down, but it is right down the middle. And Dalton gets below that baseball and rips it off the center field wall. Watch him get below this ball. Gets below that ball, launches it, and this ankle looks like he's moving just fine right about now. This is called hitting the jets and smelling a triple, and he is in high gear right there. And that is an elite athlete running around the bases. Will Dalton all fired up as the Gators take a 4-0 lead.
It's his first triple of the season. He had the big hit last night with a three-run home run in the third. And now it's a three-run triple in this third. J.J. Schwartz doubled his first time up. Infield is in for Kentucky, down four.
And really, this game is boiled down to, obviously, Jelly walks, but the difference between Jackson Coar being able to execute with runners in scoring position and Sean Jelly, to this point, not being able to execute with runners in scoring position. And even though that pitch was down, it was middle. It was certainly not the location that he was looking for. And with a bat path like Will Dalton, which is low to high, he can get under pretty much any pitch that's not bouncing.
Schwartz chases the breaking ball. It's the fourth strikeout for Sean Jelly, but balanced by three walks. Two down.
Another story here, Tommy. At 65 pitches in the third, when you ran through most of your bullpen last night, they're going to need him to tighten this thing up and keep him in the ballgame much deeper than he's at right now.
Ground ball to the right side. It will be a long inning for Sean Jelly. A 36-pitch frame. And just as important, Will Dalton with a bases-clearing triple. The number one team in the country leads 4-0. All right, Schick, thanks. Elsewhere, Super Bulldog weekend in Stark, Vegas. And Arkansas leads 4-0 over Mississippi State. Have you been to Starkville this year?
I have not.
I can't wait to see the new Duty Noble, but I haven't been around.
Oh, man, I know. And I hear the whole thing won't be completely finished until, the summertime, but what I've seen of it is already spectacular. That is going to be the crown jewel when all said and done.
The barbecue smoke is wafting through the outfield already tonight. Here's Tristan Pompey. By the way, each of these two programs will be in new digs soon. Kentucky will move into its brand new on-campus stadium next year, and it is going to be sensational.
Kevin O'Sullivan got a tour of it today from Nick Mangione. At least he was scheduled to. I'm not sure if that went down, but because he's got plans of his own. What is it, 2020 when Florida's supposed to open? And Scott Strickland, you know, knows how to do baseball.
Well, I think, you know, I haven't talked to the Florida AD about this, but I think one of the most beneficial things coming from Scott Strickland is that he knows that college baseball can be a revenue sport.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't know, I haven't looked at the books, but, you know, you compare Florida from their home attendance relative to the success of the program, and I think it's fair to say they lag behind some other teams within this league.
No doubt.
They aren't a whole lot of creature comforts at McKeithen Stadium.
No, they just aren't.
When it's 88 degrees and sunny out, you'd like to find some shade.
Yeah, there's no roof. There's no real place for the students to hang.
No suites, essentially.
Yeah, right. No suites.
So all that's changing with their new ballpark that will open in 2020, and Kentucky's will open next year. It's already basically up, so you can get a good feel for it with a walkthrough. And I think Kentucky showed a lot of people just how big baseball can be on this campus with what they did last year, hosting a regional and packing this place out.
And I think Mitch Barnhart specifically showed that Kentucky wants to be in the mix long term in the sport of baseball, because from a tradition standpoint, you wouldn't think that they were going to invest $50 million in the new stadium, but that's what they have done, folks. As you get a look at it, $49 million in the new baseball stadium for Kentucky baseball. This will be as nice as anybody's in the country. Just a beautiful new ballpark that will be just what, behind Commonwealth Stadium?
Yeah, just adjacent to the football stadium.
Suites and turf and amenities for the players that'll be on par with anybody in this conference. And if you are on par with anybody in this conference, you are in the top 1% of college baseball.
Yeah. Another bunt from Kentucky. India, bare hand, fires and threw it wide. On his way to second is Becker. The recovery is there, and he's out at second base. Just when you thought the number one team in the country had made a mistake to end the inning, or to keep an inning going, all of a sudden they recover.
And I think they're going to ask for a review here. India just not able to get this throw inside the bag enough. Credit Blake Reese over there, plays the carom, throws a strike to Lippitt. Does the foot get underneath the tag? I think it did. Lippitt with a poor job finishing that play. Let's see. I think he misses him. I think he's safe.
I think the first angle was the better one. Kind of hard to tell from that one. But what a job by Blake Reese to recover from that wide throw.
So Lippitt goes reaching a little bit. Instead of putting that tag right at the front part of the base, he goes reaching for the leg of Becker. And I think this one's going to get overturned, and Kentucky's going to have a runner in scoring position. See how he's reaching out there, Tommy? You got to get that glove right down to the front part of the base. I tell my little man this all the time. You start reaching for a base runner, especially in the era of replay, and you're going to miss a lot of tags when it gets down to slow motion time, as it looks like Luke Becker's foot slides in there.
You told Connor that already? He's only a week old.
Yeah, you got to coach him early, Tom. You got to coach him up early.
Tag came just below the knee.
The reach right there gets him. If that glove's on the ground, he's out. Instead, it's right around his shin, and I think he will be called safe. So that'll go what? Single and an error? Seen it the way I'm seeing it?
Yeah. I just didn't really have anything to add for the last 20 seconds.
I just, the umpires obviously are not as sure as we are. I don't think he clips him on the foot right there.
I will point out, in their defense, is sometimes, and I haven't seen this one here in Kentucky, sometimes the equipment that they have isn't as nice, say, as the 50-inch flat screen that you have down in the man cave at the Burke House. So it's new to them too.
Yeah,
you know,
that's fair.
The amount of replay that they're looking at this year is more than they ever have.
And And this was a Mingione challenge, correct?
I did not catch that.
I saw him come out and ask, but I don't know if they initiated it on their own as well.
I only saw the umpire signal that they were going to replay, but they are supposed to point to one of the dugouts to let us know exactly whether or not it's a challenge, and you get two challenges per side per nine innings. Would it be crazy, and I would apply this to all sports, would it be crazy if we put a time limit on replays?
No. I don't think so at all. Like, if you can't figure it out in 2 minutes, then keep the call on the field.
Yeah. I don't think it's indisputable that it takes you that long to figure it out. It is a Nick Mingione challenge, we're told.
I appreciate the for all the infielders at home, Blake Reese does a great job of showing you your job. Bunt to third base. My job is to get behind first base. It's always your job, but it's a high probability, especially on a play like that, that there's going to be an errant throw. And then to play it off the brick wall, which is one of the options you have here at Cliff Hagin Stadium, and throw a strike to Lippitt. He gave them a chance to get an out right there. Yeah. You know who's really ticked about that is India. He was gonna avoid getting an error, but now he's got to wear an E5 on the throw.
Yeah, his fourth of the year.
Lippitt owes him lunch for that one.
They're going to allow Jackson Kowar a couple of warm-up pitches here.
And that's just a do-or-die play, an extremely difficult play. He did a very nice job. He had a chance to get him out. If the throw's a little more up the line, he's got a chance to get him out. But a difficult chance goes the Wildcats' way. And now Cole Cottom's got a chance to get Kentucky back in this ball game.
Cottom tied for sixth in the country in home runs. He's hit 13. Bounced into a double play his first time up. Sixth in the SEC in slugging percentage. And you see the value. It's evident immediately of Nick Mingione challenging that call. Number one, he got it right. But you get a chance to get a run here in the third inning. You also cause Jackson Kowar to throw a handful more pitches.
A pretty good pitch right there. But that they have the book on Cottom, which is you got to crowd him. This is a really strong kid who can hit the ball out from foul pole to foul pole.
Within the league, only Will Dalton has hit more home runs than Cottom. 14-13. Upstairs.
On a couple marginal pitches, don't go Jackson Kowar's way, and now he's got big problems. Another one of the bashers in the middle of this Kentucky lineup gets a chance, and with one swing of the bat, we could have ourselves a one-run ball game. And Sully's pumped. We should have a Sully cam. We really should, shouldn't we?
Yeah. That's. I find that very entertaining. I would watch.
I really do. Especially back in the days when he used to manage against John Cohen. A Sully cam would have been must-see TV.
Breaking ball to Hire and a snap throw behind the runner at second. That's Becker. Every time Mississippi State would attempt to go with an inside move, try to slow down the game.
He'd have Mike Rivera on first base, and they'd pick three times in a row.
We would tag it the exasperation cam.
Yeah.
Breaking ball in for a strike.
I tell you, the breaking ball has been better than advertised in this ballgame. We saw it earlier to get out of a jam against Alex Rodriguez. There has been more bite on that breaking ball than I've seen from him in the past. We know about the fastball command and the changeup, but if you're scouting that breaking ball tonight, you got to be pretty impressed with what you're seeing on that. And really, obviously, the entire arsenal.
Runner goes for third, swing and a miss, and wow. No throw down the line. Stolen base for Becker.
Caught him not following the lead man there, and you wonder if most of the time you'll have a signal to your trail runner to let him know you're thinking about going. I'm sure Florida would have thrown to second and tried to get the slower caught him anyway, so maybe caught him just played it safe and didn't follow his lead runner, but Becker aggressive there, now just 90 feet away for the Cats' first run.
I want to ask you about that follow-up after this pitch, okay, if you get a chance, the 1-2. What kind of signal would it be?
So it really doesn't have to be that cloak and dagger, right, just because the infielders are not staring at you. So just for me, it was contact. It might be, you know, like a tilt of the cap or a, you know, a motion of the head kind of thing, like, just stay with me, right?
And there goes the runner breaking for second. Caught him, steals 90 with everybody asleep at the wheel.
Wow.
I was watching you do the head nod like a night at Roxbury, and Cole Cottom just said, you know what? You're not paying attention? Here I go.
How about that? And Cole wisely makes sure that Kentucky wasn't trying to do the old oop-de-oop there and go backside with the draw the attention to second base and try to steal home. And Cottom walks into second base.
To third, India. That one's on the money, and that will close the Kentucky opportunity in the third. No runs, one hit, one error, and they leave two on. It's a matchup of top 10 teams, Florida and Kentucky, from the Bluegrass. Tom Hart and Chris Burke up in the booth. Happy to be joined by Nick Mingione down in the home dugout. Coach, how you doing tonight?
Better tonight. I'm not tangled up by this fishing wire.
Yeah, good thing. You're a pro at this stuff now. Hey, I just wanted to ask you. I mean, it's a Friday night under the lights. The weather isn't exactly perfect, but you have a great crowd on hand here once again. What is the support of this entire state and specifically Big Blue Nation meant to you in this program over the last couple years?
Oh, it's been huge, man. You know, we've set and broke 5 attendance records now, and it's been a lot of effort on a lot of people's part, man. Berkey, you've been coming here a long time, man. It's kind of neat to see the temporary bleachers, and look what they got going out there in the outfield, man. This is a really neat SEC home field advantage here at Kentucky.
Well, it's certainly better than it's ever been here at the Cliff, but it's going to look a lot different next year, am I right? What are you most excited about with the new place? We just showed it last inning.
Well, you know what? To have something new, right, for the players, you know, I'm just so appreciative of Dr. Capiluto and Mitch Barnhart, what they've been able to do and how they've invested their, you know, resources in our baseball program. But for our players to have something new, that's really important, because you know what, you guys go all over the country and around our league. There's some beautiful facilities. So for us to have our own and it be brand new is really neat.
Coach, I want to ask you about Sean Jelly. He has been magnificent all season, but for the first time since the Arkansas game, walked a few guys in the third inning. What's different from him tonight, or what was different in that third?
Well, you know what, I thought him getting his fastball away to them right-handed hitters, it was just, he was kind of hooking it and getting it down. You saw some, he made some really good pitches to some of them righties in, but like on that side of the plate, he's been getting the ball there, but he hadn't been able to get the ball to the other side of the plate as well. But one thing I know about this guy, man, you look at him, he ain't going to stop competing, and he's really good competitor.
Hey, Nick, great to see you this weekend. We appreciate your time.
Guys, man, thanks for all you're doing. And Berkey, so good to see your boy out here with the field, man. I'm just and so appreciative and blessed that the newborn's doing great.
Thank you. Yeah. Appreciate it.
Thank you, guys. Go Cats.
Hey, Coach Nick Mingione. You know, Kevin O'Sullivan spent some time with your boy Jackson today and asked him if he could recruit him to be a Florida Gator. Tell everybody at home what Jackson's immediate response was.
No. I mean, I'm like, kid, you have no clue what you're doing and who you're talking to, and he just no sense of what anything other than he doesn't like when Florida beats Tennessee in football. So the fact that the Florida head baseball coach asked him if he wants to be a Gator, have you ever heard a quicker no in your life?
Yeah, from my wife a few times early on, but eventually broke her down. And I thought that Kevin O'Sullivan did a fantastic job. I got some insight into what makes him such a great recruiter, because he looked right at your son and he said, you know what, I've been told no plenty of times. I'm going to stick on you because we got plenty of years to try and get you ready. Here you are, getting some work in with the little guy.
Yeah, we were working hard. He loves being able to hop in the car. We live in Louisville, so he can hop in the car and come when I do these games in Lexington. He likes to tell me what to do and where to throw it. But, yeah, Sully promised to stick with him, even though Jay didn't give him much reason for hope, did he?
No, he did not. A pop-up to the left side, and here's Rodriguez in foul territory. Might be another Berkey on the field sometime soon doing that same thing. Tell that story when we return, and we'll also spend some time with Brady Singer. It's a 4-0 Florida lead. That is great stuff. And Brady Singer joins us on headset now from the Florida dugout with his buddy Jackson Kowar on the mound. You seriously showed up to campus with a laundry basket, a fishing pole, and a lamp?
Yeah, and the fishing pole was the most important one.
Were the clothes in the laundry basket clean?
They honestly might not have been. It depends if mom cleaned them or not.
By the way, for folks who want to see more of that interview with Kyle Peterson, Jackson Kowar, and Brady Singer, that's going to air in its entirety, the extended version, on SEC Now tonight after this game. You know, we were talking about it last night during your start. It was a bit of a surprise that you even showed up on campus, because the Blue Jays used their second-round pick on you. Now, it didn't work out. They seemed to think that your arm wasn't as good as it was for a variety of reasons. But the reason I bring that up is I'm curious what kind of motivation that provided to you once you got on campus.
Oh, no, it was excellent. You know, I think the first day that I got here, I started immediately throwing. You know, started throwing, you know, foul pole to foul pole. That was kind of my goal, you know, making sure my arm was fine. You know, everything was fine, you know, in my world, and I was just happy to get on campus and, you know, get working. And I'm, you know, really excited, you know, that it happened almost, because I've had a great 3 years here, and, you know, the national championship last year was the icing on the cake.
Yeah, you bring it up, Brady. It's been incredible to watch your development. And last night, KP and I were marveling at just how much you've grown as a pitcher, because it you know, when you came on campus, you were kind of sinker slider guy, and it was a lot of arm side run. And now I watch you get the ball to your glove side with ease. You're throwing the breaking ball at a ridiculous rate for a strike. And then last night we saw kind of that upshoot heater that it looks like you've been throwing, where you're kind of elevating the fastball late. What would you point to specifically has been the biggest part of your maturation and growth personally or on the field?
I think, you know, commanding the ball. You know, I feel like, you know, a lot of high schoolers, you know, including me, are, you know, kind of gunslingers. They kind of just get up there and they sling it and, you know, right by people. And, you know, developing the third pitch, you know, like the changeup. You know, I threw it a lot, you know, last night, later in the game. So that changeup has really, you know, came a long way since I've got here. You know, in high school, I was a sinker slider. And like I said, just kind of throwing it, both pitches. But, you know, definitely developing all three pitches and, you know, making them better is, you know, really been good.
2-2 to Shin, misses low and away from Jackson Kowar. You guys have been roommates for a while now. What's the grossest thing that he does?
Oh, I mean, he's got some logic problems, I'll tell you that. he'll let some clothes hang out in this room for a while.
You're the guy that showed up to campus with dirty clothes in the laundry basket, and you're busting him for having poor laundry skills,
yeah,
huh?
Yeah, I know.
What's it like? What's an off day like for you guys at your place?
Well, I'm kind of on my own now. Kowar actually retired from golf for swing mechanic reasons.
It's a very nice way to put it.
It's if he's trying to hit the batter's eye, it's going to hit our bus, which our bus is located to straight right.
Okay.
So it's not going well for him.
There's definitely better things he can do with his time than to be out there.
Yeah, for sure. But, no, it's hard to get him out there, you know, lately. He hasn't golfed in a while. But
so who's your guys? Like, who gives you a game out there?
Freshman Tommy Mace. I've been playing with him.
Okay.
Yeah, he's really good at golf. You know, Michael Byrne and Coleman. Byrne's good, too.
Yeah, I could see that.
Yeah.
High pitch ability guy. Now, hey, give me the rundown. Your team as it stands today and your team 1 year ago, obviously you guys went on to win national championship, but how would you explain the differences in the club, maybe with the clubhouse dynamics or even on the field, whichever one you want to go with that?
Yeah, you know, I think the clubhouse, you know, I think it's a huge part of the game, a huge part of the team. I think it's excellent. You know, everybody on the team loves each other when we play as a team. And I think it shows out here on the field. You know, we never have any problems, you know, off the field or on the field. It's just an awesome team to play for. You know, like y'all are talking about the offense coming out this year. It's a really, you know, really incredible year for us. And, you know, like I said, I'm excited to get into the postseason. You know, we're missing, you know, Fido last year, obviously. But, you know, the pitching carried us a little bit last year, but the hitting coming around is really going to help us.
Does it change your mentality when you actually have some runs to work with as opposed to last year when you're sweating out a bunch of 1-0, 2-1 games?
I guess you could lose focus. You know, that's something I try not to, is lose focus as much, especially in the third inning when we put up six. But, you know, it's making games longer, I'll tell you that.
Gives you a chance to throw some change-ups,
yeah,
though, right?
Exactly. No, that was awesome.
You play with Jonathan India every day, and this guy is somebody he's impressive to us when we see him once every couple of weeks. What impresses you the most about his game?
There's a lot of things to say about Indy. You know, he's a hardworking kid. You know, he plays hard. He loves to play. You know, I'm super glad to be one of his teammates. He's an awesome kid. You know, like I said, he plays hard, and I love hard-nosed kids that play like that. And just to watch him, you know, go about his business every day, it's really cool to watch.
We were watching BP today, and as Sully goes to the mound, in fact, let me change my line of questioning here. Take us inside a mound visit from Kevin O'Sullivan. What is he saying right now?
Oh, I like that.
Oh, you know, he's probably trying to calm Jackson down. You know, he's got, you know, one out, runner on second and first probably. I believe so.
Yeah, you're right.
You know, just trying to locate pitches. He's got one out, so really all he needs is two ground balls, and he's out of it.
So are most of those mound visits execution conversations, or will he come out there and get in you a little bit if he needs to?
If he needs, yeah. I mean, if he thinks it's the right time, you know, I mean, you know, Sully, he's going to get into you, which is, you know, I love it. I like it.
Well, it goes back to where I was leading you a moment ago. Berkey and I are sitting there watching BP today, and Chris looks at me and he says, this whole thing with Florida, like, this is being run like a pro team. It's such a relaxed atmosphere. Everybody's responsible for their own work and responsible to get it done. Do you see that, and do you appreciate that as a player?
No, I love it. Yeah. No, absolutely, because the coaches, you know, they're not putting a bunch of stuff in your head. You know, if you need coaching, they're going to coach you. But if you don't, you know, if you kind of got it, obviously not figured out, but if you're rolling and you kind of know what you're doing and you're going about your business the way you should, they're going to leave you alone and let you play, which is awesome.
Yeah, that's definitely something I've noticed. I was even asking Sully last night about you starting to climb the ladder with that put-away fastball, and I was asking him, is that something y'all been working? Like, no, I don't know. He's just been doing it lately.
Yeah, he mentioned it, and I rolled with it. You know, I like it. I think it's a good pitch.
Yeah, I'd stick with it.
Yeah.
This is an environment that you're probably used to, but I think fans at home get a better feel for how important the game is when there are 50 scouts watching on a nightly basis. What does that do to you? And do you consider that when you're on the mound in a big game like you were last night?
No, not at all. I'll be honest, I don't really see them. You know, I try not to look in the stands. You know, I'm just trying to win games. You know, obviously it's a draft year and all that, but, you know, the goal, you know, for the next, you know, few weeks and this whole season is to win ball games on Friday night.
Well, you're doing a fantastic job at it. Thanks for spending some time with us. We appreciate it.
Yeah, no, thank y'all. Y'all take care.
That's Brady Singer trying to stay warm tonight. His roommate Jackson Kowar gets a strike there. 1-2 the count.
That's a dude. All caps.
Yeah.
He everything about him is professional. The way, you know, how relaxed he is. He's one of those kids that when he tells you he's not thinking about the draft, I believe him 100%. I mean, it is all about competition to him and what he knows, and it's a maturity that you can tell just kind of exudes from him. What he knows, if he dominates and he does and he competes, like, the draft will take care of itself. He doesn't have to put too much energy in thinking about it.
Shortstop Trey Dawson at the plate. Kentucky 0-for-4 with runners in scoring position tonight. I think sometimes that's easier said than done for college juniors. Jammed him, and India goes to second for one. The turn by Reese. Got it! Florida turns a double play to end the inning. They go around the horn. India to Reese to Smith. We'll see the top of the order do up for the number one team in the country. Florida doing it in all facets tonight.
Boy, Kohar just keeps getting out of jams. How about this 5-4-3? Reese doing an outstanding job of finishing it off.
Ishik, thanks, brother. Ground ball up the middle. Range the left side. Dawson.
Do it.
Nice stretch. Caught him.
Very nice, Trey Dawson. Ranging to his left. The quick release as the energy's taking him towards right field. Sidearm and caught him with a nice job doing the splits and getting to the inside part of the bag to receive that baseball. Look at the low three-quarter arm angle there as Dawson's momentum's taking him into shallow right field, and a beautiful job by Cottom of finishing that play.
Here's Nelson Maldonado at the plate. Shows bunt, takes a strike. I want to go back to what we're talking about with Brady Singer last half inning and the observation you had that this Florida team is very loose. They're relaxed, and it's like a pro atmosphere. There's more than one way to skin a cat. A lot of teams, coaches handle their organizations differently than the way Kevin O'Sullivan handles his.
Yes.
What I'm getting at is why is it successful? Because then why doesn't everybody do it that way? You know, would be the next question.
I think that Florida obviously has as talented of players as anybody has in the country. And I think there's a lot more coaching and structure that goes on that we don't see on game day. I think on game day, it is the most relaxed atmosphere that we observe. I mean, I don't know that I'd say anybody's close. I mean, like today, it's a beautiful day, game two of a series, and they're hitting BP, and the starters are, some of them are taking ground balls, some of them are in the dugout. Nobody's in the batting cages, which usually we see stations, and if you're not on the field hitting, you're in the cage hitting, and then you've got a defensive station and a base running station, and you're always somewhere, right? You just don't see that with Florida. Yet, year in and year out, they run the bases as well as anybody. You never see Florida make mistakes on the bases. They play arguably the best defense in the league every year. They throw the most strikes. You never see communication problems on pop-ups or relays. So you know there's coaching and player development going on. But on game day, it just has a very relaxed, confident feel to it. And it is unique for college baseball, but specifically this league.
Certainly helps when you have elite players, and that's what Jonathan India is. Leading the league with a .424 average. He hits for average. He hits for power. He gets on base. We saw a triple crown winner in the league last year, Brent Rooker of Mississippi State. And India would have a chance to win that award this year. Some competition in the home run department, no doubt. But we hadn't had a winner of the Triple Crown since Rafael Palmeiro was in a Mississippi State uniform. Line to right field. Higher got it on the hip. Three up and three down for Jelly. In fact, he's retired seven in a row. Got the ESPN app fired up right now. Arkansas leads Mississippi State 5-0. Chris Burke will have his fired up tomorrow to watch the Tennessee spring game. That's 2 o'clock Eastern, followed by Mississippi State at 4, and then LSU at 6. All of those will be on the SEC Network and, as always, on the ESPN app.
I know you're fired up to go to Knoxville this fall.
Why would you think that? Like, what gives you that impression?
Because, man, you know it's just the start of the Jeremy Pruitt era. You know that this is, like, you're going to get in on the ground floor of something special. I mean, you just know it. You just know it.
Ground floor might be right. There's Tristan Pompey. He's 1-for-2 with a double.
You're always so encouraging, Tom. Well, so love calling you in the fall.
It's too easy. It is too easy with you. How the last couple of games, two of the last three games against Florida worked out for you on the football field?
Really bad.
Yeah. Pompey rides this one to left center.
How about like 11 of the last 12?
Four bad mix. Well, I just thought.
But two of the last three
were just daggers.
Particularly heartbreaking. Mm-hmm. This one was probably the worst of all of them.
Big bend right, I believe, was the play call. Same play call both game winners.
Big Ben Wright. He'll roll right, throw left play. That's what it was.
That could be it. Get behind the secondary play.
Make them think we're not throwing it left and then launch it as far as you can.
Here's Troy Squires. That's all right. Kentucky knows what it's like to lose to Florida at the last minute. They left a couple wide receivers wide open in a tough Saturday night loss at Commonwealth Stadium this past fall.
Yeah, that was rough. Mm-hmm. That Kentucky-Florida football streak is getting a little out of control.
Little bit. You know, if you think about it, and this is me shooting off at the mouth. I don't have the research in front of me, but
you just
don't see streaks like that, even related to baseball numbers. You just don't see that in this league because through the years, everyone has been competitive.
Oh, yeah, you don't. No.
That was a great pitch.
And what's interesting, to bring it back to the game at hand, in baseball, Kentucky is the only team that has a winning record against Florida over the last few years. They've won 10 out of the last 17 games against the University of Florida. Nobody in the league else is above 500. So they do claim ownership over them in at least one sport, but football is definitely not one of them.
So two up and two down with Luke Becker coming to the plate.
Ownership might be a little strong, but above 500.
Yeah. Best among SEC teams. It's going back to 2013.
If I was Nick Mangione, I would have been disappointed that today was such a nice day. I would have wanted it about 45 and cloudy when the Gators come up north.
Did you feel that when you, I mean, Knoxville's a little bit further south of here, but when you went to Florida early in the season, did you feel that as a player?
Oh, did I feel it? It was a welcome change of climate. It was glorious is absolutely what it was. Can he get there?
Yes! Covering some ground. Oh, I wish we had Statcast at this level. That was a perfect route run by Nick Horvath with top-of-the-line speed.
Probably doesn't get enough love for his glove. Nick Horvath, as good a center fielder as this league has to offer, a beautiful route and excellent job of finishing that play for the Gators.
Monday, we'll have the only SEC softball game on this schedule. It's a finale of a three-game series between 10th-ranked Tennessee and number 17 Alabama at Rhodes Stadium in Tuscaloosa. That's Monday Night Softball, 7 Eastern, 6 Central, right here on the SEC Network and streaming live on the ESPN app. Tom Hart alongside Chris Burke. He told Kyle Peterson not to come to work today. Sixth inning from Lexington. And Will Dalton to lead things off. KP will be in, well, he is in Boston, but they got a big one tomorrow night, a game that's more important than the game itself. Florida State and Boston College playing in the ALS awareness game at Fenway Park. It's on ESPNU tomorrow. And 11, Mike Martin getting closer and closer to catching up with the late Augie Garrido for the all-time wins leader in college baseball history.
His club scuffling a little bit. They thought maybe if they were...
I think you mean struggling.
No, scuffling is exactly what I meant, but thank you. I know there's some viewers out there that don't like that term, but I prefer it. Anyhow, there was some hope that maybe he was going to break the record this weekend, but the Noles have lost 5 in a row, and that's not going to happen now for another couple weeks.
One down with J.J. Schwartz coming to play. Mike Martin sitting at 1,970 career wins. Augie Garrido passed away earlier this season. 5 national championships in his time between Cal State Fullerton and Texas. Finished his career with 1,975. The last 3 ALS awareness games have gone BC's way. Includes last year when it was played at Fenway for the first time. Pete Frates, the former Boston College captain, played for Pete Hughes, who's now on the Georgia staff. Suffers from ALS. He wants to be the face of the cure. He's the one that came up with the ice bucket challenge, if you remember that.
Weren't you supposed to do that tonight?
And he did it. I did it years ago at Turner Field.
Oh,
It was cold. It was wet.
That's the name.
Mm-hmm. Schwartz 1-for-2 with a double and a run scored. Elsewhere in the ACC, a big matchup on Tobacco Road. NC State and Duke, that's a top 10 matchup. It's the only top 10 matchup that will have been played this season outside the SEC. And they're in the ninth inning in Durham. NC State leads 9-2. To the left side. At short, it's Dawson. Another nice play. By the way, North Carolina State and Duke, two teams that could very well be national seeds, depending how the season plays out.
Yeah, a couple really talented clubs right there. I think that the ACC is trying to find its way a little bit. You know, you're used to Louisville and Florida State being at the top. We see them struggling 9-9 and 8-9. But Duke and NC State, a couple clubs. Duke maybe projected there. NC State was not ranked to start the year, but a really talented and deep-hitting team. And I was digging into Duke's numbers today a little bit, Tommy, and it doesn't really quite add up. Like when you look at ERA and fielding percentage and team batting, I think they're hitting about 260 as a club.
Help me out here. Here's what I know about Duke outside of Griffin Conine. They pitch really well, and they pick it really well.
Well, the bullpen pitches really well. There's not what I would call an elite starter, but their bullpen numbers are outstanding. They've got a couple guys, I think the two of them combined in like 25 appearances have one run. So the bullpen has been outstanding, but the offense operating very similar to like a Florida last year. Now, that being said, Griffin Conine's going to get hot at some point. When he does, he can carry them to series wins. And I don't say if, but when, because I do believe he's that talented of a hitter. But they're a neat story, very similar to this Kentucky team last year. Duke's program trying to do things they have never done, which would be get to a super regional and potentially to Omaha. But, you know, there's a lot of tough tests for them down the stretch. But if they're able to answer to one of those two teams, probably going to be a national seed, Duke or NC State.
Here's Brady Smith to the plate with one on and two out. He homered last night. You're close to that Louisville program, and they're sitting right there at 500 in conference play. Are they a team this year that we should be aware of? They should be on our radar in terms of being able to turn it up?
Yeah, you know, I think if you look at what's transpired with them, they've lost three games in the last at-bat. Mm. And so they sit at 9-9. They could easily be 12-6 in league play. And they just now got Nick Bennett back, who was a freshman All-American last year. He is now back and pitching very, very well. So you got Adam Wolf on Fridays. You got Nick Bennett on Saturday. They feel really good about their young arms that are throwing on Sunday and Tuesday now. And the schedule is a little bit lighter in the back half. So don't be surprised if you look up in Louisville, that record gets real healthy real quick.
Of course, Louisville knocked off Kentucky in the Super Regional last year to go back to Omaha. Kentucky's had a couple of chances to make it to Omaha. It was last year against Louisville. Before that, when Jack McDowell was at Stanford, they were in a regional. Back then, they weren't supers. And they took game one from Stanford, or they lost game one by one run. Then Stanford blew them out the second time they matched up. That was one of the years Stanford won the whole thing. Strike three. Jelly looks to be on it now. And he gets Brady Smith looking. Fifth K for Jelly.
Fastball command, little backdoor fastball to get the Cats off the field.
Time top five matchup coming your way. A midweek game. It's number 5 Texas Tech going on the road to take on third-ranked Arkansas. That's Wednesday at 7 o'clock Eastern, 6 Central. I'll be there with runes.
Oh, you got runes?
The rune piece, yeah. Oh,
good for you.
Hashtag gamer.
Hashtag infinite knowledge.
80 hat game.
and suntan lotion or sunblock, I guess.
Sunblock, yeah. Excuse when you're me. As pasty as he yes. is, it's a block. You can find a lunar eclipse with more blockage. Here's Cole Cottom. Cleanup hitter is 0-for-1 with a grounded into a double play. Really interesting night going on in the league. Cottom goes down swinging. Arkansas right now leads Mississippi State 5-0 in the sixth inning in Starkville. Texas Tech hammered New Mexico 20-9 midweek, 20 runs for the third time in the last four games. And then what did they do today? They win a 5-4 game against a ranked Oklahoma team to open that series. Arkansas had 11 runs on 12 hits against their rivals, their regional rivals from Missouri State Tuesday. They've scored 10 runs or more 12 times this season.
Missouri State had a chance to do a little damage in this part of their schedule. They had Missouri, they had Arkansas a couple times, they had Oregon State coming to town. They had a chance to really jump up the rankings and the postseason conversation, and that two-week span has not gone too well for the Bears.
Here's Luke Heyer. Well, within the league, Tennessee has a lead tonight at home against Texas A&M.
Yeah, I tell you, the bottom of the league has really been competitive this year. I mean, you look, South Carolina beating LSU right now 5-0. Tennessee beating Texas A&M, got a chance to win on Friday night. And if Tennessee wins on Friday night, they got a chance to win the series, because with Garrett Stallings and Will Neely in the next two games, they're going to be competitive. And, of course, we know about the turnarounds from Missouri and Georgia and how good both those clubs have been. I don't know a year where the league has ever been as competitive as it is this year.
South Carolina leads at home against LSU 5-0. LSU has had a hard time winning on the road.
Yeah, it's been ugly. And Zach Hess specifically has not pitched well on the road. He struggled at Vanderbilt. He's struggling tonight at South Carolina. But the home numbers have been awfully good. You seen the freshman Mikhail Hilliard pitch yet for LSU?
Not in person.
Yeah, he's a lot of fun to watch.
Here's Ben Eklinski. By the way, our buddy Gabe Grosch getting it done tonight. His Auburn Tigers have 18 runs on 16 hits against Alabama, and we want to send our best wishes to Alabama radio announcer Chris Stewart, who is in the hospital this week. And we understand that he is on the mend after an emergency procedure, but we certainly hope he continues to improve and would love to see him at the ballpark sometime soon. Thoughts and prayers with Chris, his beautiful family. He also calls basketball games for Alabama and has been on the football crew for a long time. Here's Ryan Shin. Junior from Jobstown, New Jersey. Started his college career at Florida Gulf Coast. Then he went the JUCO route. Was fifth in the nation in home runs last year. He had 20.
Yeah, and it tells you where what they feel about T.J. Collette right now. That against a power right-handed arm like Jackson Kolar, that Collette is now really falling out of favor. He was, boy, to start conference play, he was as hot as any player in America.
Yeah.
And now he's really been struggling to stay in the lineup.
Which is weird because he came in on a four-game hit streak and he had a couple of hits in the Georgia series. Ball and a strike to Shin. Sharply hit nice to first. That'll close the frame. A run to hit. No errors with one left on. Cats have stranded 7-6. Today right here on the SEC Network, we'll have the Women's Golf and Tennis Championships. Start on the links at 9 Eastern, 8 Central from Greystone Golf and Country Club for the sixth straight year. It'll be match play format to determine the title. Then at 2:30 Eastern, 1:30 Central, we'll be at the University of Tennessee in Knoxville for the Tennessee championship matches. Everything is also streaming live on the ESPN app, so you can watch anywhere. Here's Blake Reese with a swing and a miss. By the way, I ran into SEC basketball referee John Hampton, who was at the ballpark yesterday. He played baseball here. He was talking to me about a team that lost to Jack McDowell. We got the stars mixed up, though.
Okay. Give it to me straight then.
Mike Messina beat Kentucky in that 88 regional final. Doug Sutton pitched in that game, by the way.
Yeah. Thank you, Doug.
That's a blanket.
Is that a, what do they call that? Is that a Snuggie? I think there were armholes on that.
No.
Yes.
It's just a blanket.
Jonesy, let's get another shot of that. Is there? Okay. All right. He just very, very creative, though. I feel like he's making that into kind of a Snuggie.
More major league games. Gosh, that is a good one. More major league games, by the way, postponed or canceled in the month of April than ever before. A lot of them because of the cold. Did you see the Red Sox game the other day?
I did not.
One of the guys in the pen had a sleeping bag. Jelly covering the bag. Good work by the 6'11 right-hander. Your typical 4-1.
Yeah, caught him traditionally a catcher, but he's been playing a lot of first this year. He has no business running after this ball. But fortunately, he's got a 6'11 freak show athlete on the mound who beats the other team's second baseman to the bag. Cole caught him. Is it straightaway second base by the time he realizes he has no business being over there? And Sean Jelly just gets over there like it's a walk in the park and finishes that play. That was special right there from Sean Jelly. He's so coordinated and graceful, athletic, you forget he's 6'11. He just doesn't, there's nothing about him that's awkward.
Here's Nick Horvath.
Something tells me that Nick Mangione might show that play to Cole Cottom tomorrow.
Tomorrow? He's not going to wait. Backhanded by Dawson. He's been flashing some leather tonight.
It's a beautiful backhand right there by Trey Dawson. I love it when infielders trust their backhand. That's one of those balls where he could have rushed to get around it for fear of maybe letting that ball get by him. But, boy, he posted up on that backhand and made that one look easy. See, right here, Luxem, just trust your backhand. Get your nose down there. Trust your backhand. Plenty of arm strength to get the ball across the diamond. Really nice job there of trusting your backhand from Trey Dawson.
Back to the top of the order and Deacon Lippitt. We're talking launch angle earlier this game, exit velocity and the likes. I know you get a kick out of this one. It's at the other end of the extreme. Cardinals are playing the Reds tonight. Harrison Bader moments ago reached base on a ball that came off his barrel at 72 miles an hour with minus 43 degrees launch angle.
So it hit home plate?
I mean, it seems like it.
Yeah.
It's what you would call a lucky hit, I guess.
I would think that would fall under that category, yes. The old Baltimore chop off a home plate?
Could have been. Former Gator.
I once saw Lance Berkman, right-handed, miss hit a ball so bad, and it was the first inning of a game at Pittsburgh, and they used to really get the home plate area wet.
Yeah, oh yeah.
And he hits this ball, he tops it so bad that it sticks in the mud in the batter's box, and nobody knew where the ball was for like 2 seconds. And he's looking around, nobody knows where the ball is. And it was stuck at his feet. He drove it into the ground. So I don't know what that launch was, but.
So it was a fried egg for him, huh?
I've never seen, ever before or again, had I seen anything like it. But he could chop a ball right-handed now.
High, deep. Eklinski to the track. And he makes a catch to end the frame. It's a 1-2-3 inning. Time to stretch. Jelly over the century mark. 4-0 Florida. Well, Florida did most of their damage in one inning. We take it to the third. Nick Horvath had drawn a walk. So did Nelson Maldonado and Jonathan India. Will Dalton made him pay doing this on a bum ankle after fouling a pitch off the ankle. It was a 3-run triple. And watch the reaction as he goes into third. What does he say? I can't feel my ankle.
Well, after he gets over the adrenaline rush, he explains to Craig Bell that he no longer had feeling in the ankle. But there's something about hitting a ball at the center field wall with the bases loaded that'll make you forget about the shooting pain in your ankle after fouling one off your foot.
Alex Rodriguez with a 6-3 ground out. That'll bring Dawson up. By the way, I was just kind of perusing some of the MLB leaders, Berkey. You'll like this. There's a very SEC feel to it. Dansby Swanson and Ryan Flaherty, who both played at Vanderbilt, are tied with Yasmani Grandal for the National League batting average lead right now.
Not that, Grandal of Miami Project, right?
Preston Tucker is tied with Bryce Harper for the National League RBI lead.
Do it.
Tucker, play to Florida.
The SEC just
Max Scherzer is tied for the National League win total. And Johnny Cueto.
Mizzou, by the way.
Yeah, Mizzou. Okay. I was going to make it too good. I don't think Johnny Cueto played in the SEC.
I don't think so either.
Pretty cool this season that Preston Tucker is having.
Although I'm sure Sully recruited him.
Yeah, there's no doubt about that.
We got some interesting goings on in the SEC this evening, Tommy. The Gamecocks have stretched the lead against the Tigers of LSU out to 7-0. And the Auburn Tigers are beating the Crimson Tide 18-4.
Ooh.
The Volunteers have closed it out against A&M and win a Friday night against Mitchell Kilkenny. That is, or John de Texas, I believe. Excuse me, goes Friday nights for Texas A&M. That's a huge win for Tennessee.
Trey Dawson, by the way, started his career at LSU, then went to Chipola. Dawson caught looking here. You know who else went to Chipola? That's a great baseball player through there. Jose Bautista, just signed by the Braves. Russell Martin, a former Dodgers catcher. Buck Showalter.
I did not know Russell Martin went there.
Yeah. So two down, and here's Pompey. Who is, just like Tristan Pompey.
That's right. There we go.
Which of those scores surprised you the most?
Probably South Carolina and LSU. Adam Hill can shut down the lineup when he gets it going, but the fact that they've beaten up on Zach Hess like that is pretty impressive. I still have not given up on South Carolina as a regional team. Win tonight gets them to 7-9, and I've seen Cody Morris when he's at his best. His stuff is as good as anybody in the leagues.
Deacon Lippitt, what a play.
How about it? How about the range from the Gator shortstop, ranging far to his left to get to Speedy Pompey to catch and release. The Gators are rolling.
Spring football season continues tomorrow. Three games on the SEC Network starting at 2 o'clock. It's Tennessee's orange and white game, followed by Super Bulldog weekend continuing in Stark Vegas. 4 o'clock kick there in LSU. Death Valley, Ed Orgeron at 6 o'clock. Miles Brennan at quarterback for LSU. Hey, we've got a brand new Tennessee fan in the world, and he is already all decked out in his orange. That is Connor Joseph Burke, the latest addition to the Burke family. Congratulations to you guys. He is beautiful, and the coolest thing about this is your son Jackson, who's at the game tonight, picked Connor's name.
He did. It was pretty amazing, really. He came, hey, here's Jay. Slide in here, Jay. Let's see, there he is.
Get a wave.
Yeah.
Get a wave.
Look out the window. Wave. There you go. But, yeah, Jackson was like, I like Connor, and we all kind of looked at each other and like, yeah, let's do that. There really wasn't much debate about it. We went right with it.
That last shot, the guy behind you in the beard, was he your oldest son?
He's not.
No relation?
I do have a lot of sons. He isn't one of them.
Nelson Maldonado is 1-for-2 with a walk and a run scored.
But I'm sure Connor will be watching the spring game tomorrow.
Just let Jackson know on your drive back to Louisville tonight how lucky he should feel, because he's got more airtime than I have this evening. You know, more on camera.
Who are you?
Yeah.
Who's the voice?
Dad, who is that guy over there? Here's Jimmy Ramsey. He's the new pitcher. They're going from 6'11 to 6'7. A couple of Minnesotans. He's from Minnetonka. Jelly, who we followed, pitched at Matameddy High School. 19th appearance for Ramsey, an ERA of 4.5.
Ramsey, one of the freshman arms that has earned meaningful innings for this Kentucky bullpen. They count on him to get the ball to Mockamer, who has transitioned into the closer role and has done a really nice job. Ramsey, the breaking ball still very much in the developmental stage, but throws a heavy fastball and leans on that pitch for the most part to get him through his outings. But they like the ceiling for this young man.
A walk to Maldonado. What did you think of Sean Gelly's performance tonight?
I thought he was solid. Obviously, you know, ran into some trouble in the third inning. Other than that, it was pretty low stress. You know, just the four hits. But, you know, just, you know, you walked the nine-hole hitter, Horvath, and then really nibbled with the breaking ball against India. And then I wasn't crazy about the pitch call to Dalton. Thought they maybe had him set up to chase a breaking ball there and got burned on a decent pitch. But, you know, he'll look back at this ball game, unless the offense has a big run in him. That third inning was obviously what has cost him here tonight. As an evaluator, like if I was a professional team, though, I don't think he did anything to hurt his stock. You know, he showed you breaking ball command. He showed you fastball command to both sides of the plate. There was a couple good changeups. Again, the athleticism to certainly erase any question marks about an athlete that big being able to field his position.
That's a fair ball down the line off the bat of India. Maldonado will stop at third. See if Jonathan India is on his way to another 24-game hit streak.
Just a matter of time. You knew at some point he was going to square it up. He gets a little over top of this one. Fastball running up and in that he gets just a little over top of. Watch the path of this one. So, again, those that are on, that are haters to the low-to-high bat path because they're trying to get kids to hit ground balls, I think some of them fail to realize that most of the hardest hit ground balls are coming from low to high bat pass where the hitter actually swings up too much and tops the baseball. And India scorches that ground ball right down the third baseline for a double because he actually swung over the ball.
And now you got to face Will Dalton. And our buddy Jeff Cardozo on the Florida baseball radio broadcast provides this number. Of Dalton's last 12 hits, they've gone as follows: one single, six doubles, a triple, and four bombs.
Make them count, young fella. Make those hits count. He's not been hitting meaningless singles with nobody on, that's for sure.
A young Astros fan. So he was at Minute Maid Park the night you hit your walk-off home run, right?
He was.
How old is he?
He said he was 5 or 6 when it happened. So he's, what, 19, 20 now? 20 probably? 15 years ago? Was it 15 years ago? No, so he
13
had been,
years
yeah, it was 13 years ago. So he was probably like 7.
I hope he was wearing earplugs. That place gets loud. A lot of buzzing in that building back in those days.
I think there was a lot of people sleeping at that point. They were really loud for Rocket the at-bat before, and he struck out. And when I came up, everybody sat down.
Rocket hit before you?
Well, the lineup at that point was a jumbled mess.
Yeah.
But yeah, he had entered the game. The only time he entered the game as a reliever.
Uh-oh. Breaking ball, torch deep to left field. Gone if it's fair.
Wow.
It is off the top of the pole. Will Dalton does it again, a three-run bomb.
Talk about making them count, Tommy Hart. He's got 4 hits in the series and 9 RBIs. 3 of his 4 hits have driven in 3 runs, and this is a bomb. Hanging breaking ball that is launched into the Lexington night. He took a little time to appreciate that one.
I tell you, you do something like that, I bet that gives you a chance to talk to Matt Schick after the game.
I would agree with that. That's a special night. A 3-run triple and a 3-run bomb.
You know, in basketball, they call it a podium game, right? You play well enough that you go to the podium to talk to the media. He's having a Schick game. He gets to be interviewed by Matt Schick postgame.
How high up the pole did that hit?
That was the very top.
I want to see that one again. Here's J.J. Schwartz.
A little left to right breeze kept it fair. We got the flagpole blowing pretty strong from left to right. And that certainly helped Dalton, because the only question with that ball was, would it stay fair? Because it was touched. And he can elevate the baseball. He can absolutely launch the baseball. It is a path that is going to produce a lot of extra base hits.
Check it out.
So it's a hanging breaking ball. Love the rhythm of the movement. You can see just that little bit of pause. And there's not much to worry about here. It's either fair or foul, but you know it's over the fence. And this ball, let's see what part of the foul pole did we get it? Yeah, no, it was closer to like three-fourths of the way up, not the very top. But that ball is long gone. Hit the second rung on that foul pole. What a series Will Dalton is having. Four hits, nine RBIs, and has carried this club offensively.
Okay, so let's update the number. His last 13 hits, one single in his last 13 hits, one triple, five home runs and six doubles. How's that for a slugging percentage?
Pretty good. Yeah, we're not too worried about the batting average at that point, but he is extending his league lead in home runs. Now up two on Cottom and higher.
Line drive to right. It is off the fence. Langworthy on his way to second. Misplayed by Heyer. And so Austin Langworthy has a two-hit game. By the way, Dalton is now in third place in the nation in home runs, separating himself from Illinois' Brent Spillane, Aubie Wace of Cal State Northridge, and, those guys. Because he's second now to only Spencer Torkelson, and third behind Torkelson and Andrew Vaughn of Cal. Isn't Spencer Torkelson a freshman?
He is. Broke Barry Bonds' school record for home runs as a freshman. Anytime you're breaking a Barry Bonds home run record, you're having a good year.
Yeah.
He did it in like 20 games, 25 games. He had like, I think the record was 11.
Pretty good.
Will Dalton, he's already grabbed his glove, and what, we got some animal crackers there?
Yeah.
A little post-homer animal cracker, I think we're working with there. With Marshawn Lynch, he went with Skittles.
Skittles,
right?
Yeah.
Dalton goes animal cracker. You eat whatever you want. You keep launching them into the night like that, buddy.
Can even eat cake. Pre-game spread.
So I was looking breaking ball. He threw me breaking ball. I really wanted to hit it over the foul pole, but I think the wind cost me a couple of feet. That's how that conversation's going. Tell you, this is my first look at Brady Smith. They really like the future of this young man. Earning playing time on one of the most talented teams on the country as a true freshman is not easy to do, but they're trying to get his batting lineup any chance they can.
First look at him, you look a little bit like Matt Damon to you?
Yes. Yes, I would agree with that. One of the things you notice about all these Florida players, all of them have very strong lower halves. I mean, these kids are put together. Not a lot of tall players, but really, really strong below the waist. And for a freshman, I know he can catch some too, but man, he is put together there. India, Maldonado, Horvath, Langworthy. I mean, this is a group of kids that are definitely getting it done in the weight room. Let's take a look at Will Dalton, the man of the hour. So we got the fastball down that he gets below and launches off the center field wall for a three RBI triple. And now we got the hanging breaking ball. And you see just how deep he gets down into his knee, into his back knee on a pitch that's going to hit the ground. Excuse me, that's a fly ball out. This is the home run right here. And look at the blur of the bat. You can see the way the bat is traveling and how the ball exits. And then the follow-through position. Well, it is a low to high path that produces the ball flight that he gets. And I say low to high, it's relative to the pitch. So it's not like he's way below the baseball, but he is certainly, you can see the intent of the swing is to get the ball airborne. And with the bat speed he has and the strength that he has, he certainly can live with that path and do a whole bunch of damage.
That last swing we saw would be perfect for you to demonstrate launch angle, wouldn't it?
It would be.
The blur coming off the bat, that was pretty good.
And the launch on that one way up the foul pole, I would say that was probably in the mid-30s. We'll have to check with our TrackMan guys on that one, but Will Dalton is getting it done.
And Jimmy Ramsey's night is done. He gives way to Carson Coleman. Coming up next, I believe it's Matt Schick. I'm just going to say it's Matt Schick and Ben McDonald. I know he's in there with his purple bow tie. They will comprise the SEC Now team tonight. They'll break down all of the baseball and softball games tonight. There's also an NCAA Gymnastics National Championship I'm sure they'll talk about. Nobody covers the SEC like we do. You can always watch on the ESPN app as well. So here's Carson Coleman.
Freshman right-hander, again, like Ramsey, getting the chance to get his feet wet and meaningful innings out of the bullpen in just his freshman year. A really quick arm, 27 strikeouts and just 16 in the third. They're excited about this young man's stuff and the experience he's gaining out of the bullpen and the meaningful innings he's getting as a freshman speak very well for what this young man's future holds.
Action tomorrow on the SEC Network. Auburn and Alabama at 8 o'clock Eastern. And then Ole Miss and Mississippi State meet in a midweek game Tuesday night at 7. Blake Reese at the plate for Florida. He is 0 for 3.
Am I going to need a big bounce back in that one after taking it on the chin tonight? I think Bama swept Auburn last year at Auburn. And that was when Auburn was in the conversation for maybe being a regional host and being swept by an Alabama team that really struggled. Certainly took them out of that conversation.
Hey, Berkey. South Carolina leads LSU 11-0 in
eight. How about that?
Through eight, I should say. That is a development.
That is a developing situation. And I'm telling you, if Cody Morris, if LSU sees the Cody Morris that I've seen against in a Tennessee game and against the Kentucky squad and the Cody Morris that beat Florida earlier in the year, South Carolina could easily win that series.
After tonight, LSU will be 2-9 away from home.
Not good.
Now, they played for a national title last year, right?
Yes.
They were just 2-7 away from home at this time last year.
Small sample size, but certainly not playing well away from the friendly confines of the box. And it starts with their big right-hander on Friday night. He has not pitched well on the road.
Well, and what makes it tough is that if you don't play better on the road, then in the postseason, you're going to be playing on the road.
That's right. LSU still in position to host, but dropping a series at South Carolina would certainly hurt that cause. Carlos Cortez, 3-for-4 in that game for South Carolina. His number's starting to get right. T.J. Hopkins finally back in the lineup. He's been out. South Carolina had a whole bunch of injuries, and they're starting to get healthy. Madison Stokes is back in the lineup. He had two hits. T.J. Hopkins back in the lineup. Noah Campbell back in the lineup. All three of those players have been out for South Carolina. Now all back and having big ball games. Hopkins with four RBIs. Cortez hit his ninth home run.
So Blake Reese goes down swinging. 2 down. And Nick Horvath coming to the plate. Horvath got a night off last night. Back in the lineup tonight. He is 0 for 2.
Georgia taking a 2-1 lead on Ole Miss. Got a chance to win on the road. Both those teams have a chance to be regional hosts. Ole Miss has a chance to be a national seed. Question on the podcast. Here's a new one for you.
Wait, what is the podcast? Why don't you and I have a podcast?
It's a great question. The D1 podcast, excuse me. Here's a question for you. Do you call all 16 seeds now national seeds or just the top eight?
The top eight. I see what you're saying, but only the top eight get to host through.
If they win.
Yeah. It's home field advantage, kind of a big deal, right?
But would you say there's a difference between saying the national seeds and the top eight? I mean, technically, they would all be national seeds.
Stop. Just stop.
I'm searching.
We're talking with about the synergy numbers that Florida uses. And Florida really uses it as scouting reports, and primarily for the coaching staff, right?
Right.
I said, well, do you have any players that are just really into it? And Kevin O'Sullivan said, we try to keep it really simple with these guys. I want to present the information easy to digest. They don't spend too much time thinking about it. I said, could you imagine if you had Chris Burke on your team? He would want every single number, and he would just dive into the whole thing like the cartoon duck swimming through the gold coins.
Yeah,
were you like that as a big leaguer when you got the scouting report?
I started, we weren't the most progressive scouting team in the league by any means. And it was a different era, right? But we did get pitch probabilities, and I did read through them. And full disclosure, I definitely had a few at-bats where I had pitch probabilities going through my mind as I was in the box and had to step out because I was thinking too much about what the stat sheet had said.
Here's a guy that doesn't think too much about anything. His name is Matt Schick.
Thank you.
All right, Matt Schick, thanks. Bases loaded for Nick Horvath, and they count 2 balls and 2 strikes. Florida with a 7-0 lead. Or pardon me, for Deacon Lippitt. I was watching the Georgia Ole Miss game.
Yes, you were. Understandably so.
They're tied at 2 in the 8th. Swing and a miss for Lippitt. That'll close out the 8th after the Gators send 9 men to the plate. Remember the movie Roadhouse? That guy Dalton cleaned up an entire town. We're not at the Double Deuce anymore. We're at the Cliff. This is Dalton's house. Tom Hart, Chris Burke in Lexington, Kentucky. This is game 2 of the series. Florida trying to win this series. They haven't lost an SEC series all season. Here's what's going on around the country. College baseball, NC State and Duke are matching up tonight. The 7th top 10 weekend series this season. A good friend of ours, Lucan Baker, is out for the rest of the year. His TCU career likely done, right? Draft eligible. Yeah. The junior came in as a two-way star, and that's the second time in the last 3 years he's had his season end early.
It's brutal.
Yeah. And then tomorrow at Fenway Park, Florida and Boston College meet the 7th annual ALS Awareness Game. We'll honor former BC captain Pete Freitas. Invite you to tune into that one on ESPNU. Boog Chambi will have the call alongside Kyle Peterson and Molly McGrath. That should be a fun one. First pitch popped up by Squires in foul territory. It's India. Jordan Butler is the new pitcher for Florida.
One of the young, talented players on this roster. Watched him take BP. Young man can swing it as well. Doing a nice job on the mound. One of the pieces that we will see in a more prominent role moving forward once Kohar and Singer move on.
It seems there's always another guy, right? That's been the secret to Florida's success. Dunning, Puck, Shore, Fajedo.
Yeah, and now it's Singer and Kohar's turn, and of course, Tyler Dyson and Tommy Mace, and Leftwich and Butler. All these guys are just waiting in the wings to carry that mantle forward.
One out for Luke Becker, who is 1-for-2 tonight. We've got Cole Cottom on deck. We're talking to analytics when it comes to swing breakdowns. That's Chris Burke's specialty. And so we're going to do a dive into that with Cole Cottom, who's on deck right now. Big power hitter. 13 home runs on the season. What do you like about Cole Cottom's swing before we show it?
Well, they only have the TrackMan numbers for home games. And so when we show you the spray chart, you'll see poolside homers. But he's got 13 homers, and of those, 8 are to center oppo. And what I like about him is that he can hit the ball out foul pole to foul pole. Do it, Deacon Lippitt. As Luke Becker lays out an infield hit on a nice play by Deacon Lippitt.
Watch his pickup by Lippitt.
Just a really nice play to his backhand. Get down there and pick it, set your feet, and the arm strength to finish the play. The Luke Becker certainly looked like he beat it. Really nice throw by Deacon Lippitt. Luke Becker with another multi-hit night for him. But what I like most about his swing is that he can launch the ball to really any part of the field. Does a nice job of letting it travel. Now there's some room to pitching up and especially up and in. But if you make a mistake out over the plate, he can launch it to center, right center with anybody in this league.
Vandy and Mizzou are tied at 1 late in the game in Columbia. That's bottom of the 8th. Missouri won that one last night?
Yeah, 2-1. So hits are at a premium in that one. Some really talented arms going.
Two and zero the count. You taking your chopper home or something?
Yeah, I told my guy to be here
About now?
Yeah, about now. Around, you know, 10:30 or so. He's a little early. Right now.
Towards the gap. Well hit. This one will be off the base of the fence. And Cottom in safe at second base.
So you ask me what I like the most. It's, man, he uses the whole field, and this ball is scorched in the right center gap. Contact point just inside the front foot. Now we'll take a look at his TrackMan numbers on a 25-degree launch, 110-mile-an-hour homer. Does a really nice job of staying behind the baseball to create the carry out front. And the arrow shows you the 25 degrees that ball is leaving the bat. And at 110-mile-an-hour exit velocity, a 25-degree ball is getting way out of the ballpark, especially here at the cliff.
Down the line, Keenan Bell in at first base, and that one's over the brick wall. Here's a spray chart provided by TrackMan for Cole Cottom. These are home runs.
Yeah, so at home, you see he's four home runs all to the pool side. And if you looked at this spray chart, you'd think he was a dead pool hitter. But, again, has 13 home runs on the season. And neutral parks are on the road. He's done a lot of his damage to center, right center. Which is surprising because at this ballpark, you'd think he'd run into a few miss hits out to right center.
Yeah, it's
with his strength.
310 down the line.
310 to the right, 340 in the gap.
You played in a place in Houston that was, you know, laughably. Oh, nothing laughing matter there. Short to left. Did guys rework their swings when playing at Minute Maid?
You know, I think one of the things that this generation would have helped maybe the front offices of yesterday would have been with more data. I think the mindset then was that it was a great place for right-handed hitters. But you know what I mean? But really, what as a right-handed hitter, what it did was make you pull conscious. Because center's 436, so you can't hit it out to center. Whereas, to me, the advantage was the guys like Mike Lamb and Lance Berkman, the left-handed hitters that could really, it encouraged them to stay on the ball, let it travel, and they were able to pop it out to left with ease.
Bases loaded for Bennett Klinsky, and Kevin O'Sullivan's going to make a trip to the mound. And you can tell me I'm wrong, but the first thing I think of is if you're a major league hitter and you pull it, it's probably going to leave a lot of
ballparks. No matter what. That's right. Yeah, so really, to me, the advantage was for the lefties. That's where they had the advantage with that ballpark. But don't get me wrong. We all, out in front of a breaking ball, or Alex Bregman, we had the Alex Bregman home run we showed last night. He had the slowest home run of anybody in baseball last year on a fly ball to left that got out that jammed him. So
there, it was at like 84 miles an hour.
84 or 88, yeah, something like that. It was the slowest home run in the major leagues last year.
Missouri's threatening. Trey Harris at the plate now in the eighth inning with a runner in scoring position. Tied with Vandy at one. So Butler has allowed a single, a double, and then he plunked Luke Heyer.
And what we've learned from Butler's outing is just how good Jackson Kohar was tonight.
Sure.
Because he made it look awfully easy running through this talented Kentucky offense. And Jordan Butler not making it look nearly as easy as he's laboring to get through the heart of this Kentucky order, which there's no shame in that. There's a bunch of pitchers that have struggled to get through the heart of this Kentucky order, but boy, Jackson Kohar made it look awfully easy. And there were certainly some high-stress moments for Kohar, but just did a really nice job of pitching out of trouble and couple double play balls that really helped.
Got a double play in the first and another double play in the fourth.
Yeah, so I mean, you know, back to our early theme, which was I think this was a really meaningful night for both pitchers. Certainly Kohar
handled the moment better than another double play maybe here.
The second for one. Reese to first. Not in time. Blake Reese wants him to challenge it. And brings a run home for Kentucky. 7-1. I don't think Kevin O'Sullivan's worried about it in a seven-run game.
And I think this is where replay has changed the game more than anything. I think, Tom, you and I both have called plenty of games where this guy was just being called out. It's 7-0. It's the eighth inning. Let's get off the field. But they got it right. Credit Jason Millsap for getting it right. I just think, in general, the replay era has changed the way a lot of these calls are made now on the bases.
Wait, hold on. Here's Ryan Shin. So are you saying that the game was better when you would take a hit away from a guy? I mean, it was a fielder's choice, but you might be taking a hit away from a guy because it's 7-0, it's a little bit chilly, and the game's been decided?
No, I'm saying I think it's better now that the umpires are bearing down on every call just to get it right because they know the eye in the sky is going to get them if they don't.
Yeah.
But we'd be in between innings right now 2 years ago, last year. And at the major league level, that has absolutely changed the game.
I think the biggest change, having watched it for a while at the major league level, is the play at second base, specifically stolen bases. It used to be you beat the throw, you were safe.
Yeah.
But the throw beat you, you were out no matter what.
Yeah.
Well, now all of a sudden we have more to look at.
Well, we had a tag play here tonight. It's exactly the same thing, right? Everybody was running off the field. And it's like, well, no, I think the foot got underneath the tag.
What's odd to me, and to me the most, Kevin O'Sullivan's making a pitching change here. The easiest play to review and to overturn is a force call. That is only an experimental reviewable call in the SEC. You find a bang bang play at first in Omaha, it can't be reviewed, which is very interesting. Florida is going to bring in closer Michael Byrne. He did not throw last night. He holds a Florida school record for saves. 7-1 here. It's not a save situation. So who do we turn to? Our savior, Matt Schick. Great place for Blue Jeans, Oxford, Mississippi. Good baseball game going on tonight, by the way, in my hometown, Columbia, Missouri. Vandy and Mizzou are tied at one in the eighth inning. Missouri looks like a postseason team.
Oh, I like Missouri. I
think, like we're lighting a fuse there? I was waiting for you to reply.
No, yeah, no, I think Missouri can win a regional. I just think their pitching's outstanding.
I just said they're a postseason team. You think they can win a regional?
Yes, and we talked about it earlier. The two numbers I care most about as it pertains to postseason success are ERA and fielding percentage. I just think that's the best thing to look at when you're judging a team. And, of course, Michael Byrne is a huge reason why Florida is the defending national champions. And when you can pitch it and you can field it, the Florida model from last year, you get a chance to beat anybody. And Missouri has that kind of club.
34-2 strikeout to walk for Michael Byrne.
One of my favorite college closers of all time. One of the best of all time. And I know exactly what I mean that. There's no hyperbole. I really think this is when you look at the fact that he just started closing early on last year and how many saves and how many ball games he saved for them last year because of how anemic the offense was at times. And what's interesting, it's not your traditional blow the doors off closer. It's a command finesse closer. I mean, the stuff's good, but he's not a blow you away kind of guy. But man, it is fun to watch him execute.
Kevin O'Sullivan had seen enough of Jordan Butler, who worked two-thirds of an inning. Walked a guy, hit a guy, allowed a double. See a pinch hitter, Ryan Johnson. Started his career at TCU, then San Jacinto Junior College. They produced a couple of dudes. Wayne Graham was a head coach at San Jac back in the day. He had a couple of pretty good players. Roger Clemens and Andy Pettit.
Yeah, they did all right.
Johnson was the opening day starter in right field for TCU in 2016 when they went to the College World Series. Two-time Under Armour All-America out of College Station High School in Texas. Perfect Game All-America in 2014. Two-time All-State player. And it just didn't work out for him at TCU, so he ended up at San Jacinto. They went to the Junior College World Series, finished second in the country. And here he is with a second chance.
And you know who else was a teammate for a semester of Ryan Johnson at San Jac? Will Dalt. Started last year at San Jac and transferred at the midway point.
I didn't know that.
Yes.
Will Dalton
went to San Jac. He was just telling me today when he came up and introduced.
So he was there in the fall.
Yep. Transferred.
So he never played in a game for San Jacinto.
Well, they played in the fall, but because they play fall games. But not the official season, but
right.
They play a lot of fall baseball in junior college. Yeah, but yeah, left at the midway point.
Down the left field line, long run, and it falls unmolested down the line. By the way, NCAA rule change, if I read this right, teams will be allowed to play a couple of fall games against outside competition next year.
Yeah, two exhibition games that don't count against your number of 56.
So you know what I would do? I would pick a big football weekend, and I would play Friday night under the lights if I'm LSU or if I'm
no
Florida
doubt.
Or Mississippi State. Can you imagine how many people would show up for a Mississippi State baseball game the night before a football game?
Oh, there's no question. Oh, how about Ole Miss Mississippi State or Southern Miss Mississippi State?
You know how much money you would oh. Last year's Super Bulldog weekend, 15,000 people showed up for a Mississippi State baseball game, and that was an exhibition football game. Line into the corner and foul, and inches away from giving Kentucky real life here in the bottom of the eighth.
Well, if I was Florida and Georgia, I'd play before the world's largest outdoor cocktail party down in Jacksonville.
You would play a game Friday night at the baseball grounds of Jacksonville.
Yeah.
The night before the football game.
That's what I would do.
I like the way you're thinking.
It might, may
and
or may not have been my idea.
And I would keep every dollar that we made off tickets. This one off the hands into left field and catch made by Langworthy. Another Kentucky threat goes by the wayside. It's a 7-1 lead. You know who I want to hear from? Not you, Berkey. Matt
okay.
Schick.
Back in Lexington, Brad Schinzer takes the mound for the Wildcats, their fifth pitcher of the ball game. Also pitched in last night's game, 11 appearances, a 5.88 ERA. A pitcher that threw a number of meaningful innings for him last year, and they're leaning on him again this season as Kentucky missed an opportunity to get back in this ball game. Last inning with the bases loaded on a near double by Ryan Johnson. The Cats still struggling to muster any offense against this Florida pitching staff.
By the way, elsewhere in the league tonight, Missouri has the bases loaded in the home half of the eighth inning, tied with Vandy at one. Tigers trying to win that series. That game available on the ESPN app.
And if you're a Kentucky fan, I would just encourage you with the fact that Florida has a way of making people look bad.
Yeah.
And see, you look what Florida did to Vanderbilt, right? And since then, Vandy's beaten Georgia and Ole Miss in series.
Okay, so then my question would be, to look at it with a critical eye, who is Kentucky? What is this
yeah.
Kentucky team? Are they the one that took two out of three from Texas Tech and nearly swept them? Or are they the one that got blown out by Arkansas and swept on the road there? And Arkansas is elite, right? And Florida is elite. But these have been non-competitive games.
You know, they beat South Carolina 2 out of 3, beat Georgia 2 out of 3, before losing to Louisville in pretty ugly fashion, and now two ugly losses here to Florida. So who are they right now? They're closer to the team that got swept by Arkansas than they are the team that beat Texas Tech and swept the Shriners Classic in Houston. But look, it's a funny game. It has ebbs and flows. They're going to get Zach Thompson back. And I think when Zach Thompson comes back, this team starts to look closer to the one that beat Texas Tech and won the Shriners Classic than the ones that we've seen against Arkansas and Florida. That being said, it's still a flawed club. You know, their defense is not elite, and certainly their pitching staff has not performed at all the way that they had hoped.
Correct me if I'm wrong here, but we haven't had a team in the history of the NCAA tournament since it expanded to 64. We haven't had a team host with a losing conference record.
Correct.
All right.
No, they got to get to 16 wins. Even a 500 conference record, I don't think they'll host.
I would say this. Kentucky, with its power supply and with its offense and with Jelly and Justin Lewis, they're not a team that I'd want to see as a two seed.
No.
Imagine if they come into your place.
Especially if they get Zach Thompson back healthy.
So if you look at this with a critical eye from outside the conference, and after tonight they will be 7-10 in conference play, should they be ranked in the top 10?
No. No, I don't think so. And, you know, I just think, again, that ball might go.
Towards the corner, long run, and it is gone. An opposite field shot for Jonathan India. Ryan Johnson ran out of room, and India's got two hits tonight in his 13th home run of the year. It's 3-10 to the corner. I think that one went 3-12.
I would agree with that. And that's the ball I was telling you I was surprised we haven't seen from Cottom yet at home. And this is...
what do you got on launch angle?
Yeah, that ball is... it's probably 42. I mean, that ball is hit straight up in the air. But again, similar to Dalton, it's just a bat path that's going to hit the ball up a lot. And lower body strength and the ability to recognize the baseball. I mean, look at the height of the balls these guys are hitting.
Kalinske chased back to the warning track.
I mean, there is one intention when you watch Will Dalton swing the bat, and he is trying to create launch. There is no doubt about it. India's all smiles right now, and that's the beautiful thing about playing this ballpark when you're a fly ball hitter.
Is it time to put a triple crown watch on Jonathan India?
No, I just don't think the RBIs will get there. I think, and his own teammate might be to blame.
You know what your license plate reads? H8ER, hater.
Yeah, he's got it. Look, he's got his own teammate to chase. He's two back in homers from his own teammate, and he's now, let's see, what's he got, 33, and Dalton has 45. He's 12 back in ribbies.
Yeah, he's got a way to go. Brent Rooker won the triple crown last year in the SEC, 387 average, 23 home runs, drove in 82.
Just a monster year. Yeah, with tonight's game, Dalton is now the league leader, passed up higher, who's also in this ball game. So he knows who he's got to catch. The problem for India is he hits in front of Dalton. So
yeah. Dalton just hit home runs.
Yeah, he Dalton's going to keep driving him in all year long.
Brent Rooker led the SEC in slugging last year by 173 points with the next closest. Pretty good.
Yeah, India and Rooker, obviously these are the end of the year numbers, and Rooker was in the 430 range for a long time last year from a batting average standpoint. But, you know, I think India could hit 23 home runs. I mean, he could get to that number. But the 82 RBI, he's just not going to get there. But he's going to pass him in runs. And Will Dalton keeps hitting homers like he's hitting. He might pass him by a meaningful number. Rooker did not have that kind of support. And I think that maybe makes the year he had even more special. That year, that team before, the year before where they won the SEC regular season championship, he was just a piece of that team. I mean, he was a very good piece. But there was a whole bunch of dudes on that team. Last year, And it was the Brent Rooker show.
I just like it when you refer to a baseball player as a dude.
Well,
it's a qualifier in your language.
There's no doubt. Yeah, you got to earn that word. But if anybody's ever earned it, Brent Rooker has.
This is Brady Smith at the plate. No, I'm sorry. It's Keenan Bell. Don't believe what I say.
I figured that out a long time ago.
You figured out it was Keenan Bell? You didn't tell me?
Yeah.
Rooker is in the Reds organization, by the way. He's...
The Reds or the Twins?
Twins, sorry. They changed it. He's in Chattanooga. I saw that lookout's hat, and I just immediately thought Reds. No, he's the Twins organization. He's at AA Chattanooga in the Southern.
How's he doing?
He's hitting 289.
Okay. Got some homers?
Yeah, one.
All right. He's a great follow on Twitter, by the way.
Oh, he's hysterical. By the way, he's got a four-game hit streak going, including tonight. One for four tonight.
My most recent, or his most recent tweet that made me laugh out loud, which he seems to have one a week, but when the Masters was going on and they Nike came out with the special issued Nike cleats that were like Masters flowers and azaleas and stuff on it. He quoted the tweet with, "Take all my money."
Oh, India is not just a continent. He's a really good baseball player, too. Jonathan India with a two-run home run. That's his 13th of the season. Gators chopping. Lexington, Florida has a 9-1 lead as we go to the home half of the ninth inning.
Count me in as a big fan of Steve Beasley.
Yeah.
What he's done in Missouri in a very short period of time, I think Missouri is a team that has a real chance in a league and in a sport where it's very difficult to move up. I think Missouri is just going to continue to trend up and up in the SEC East.
Well, I think what's really impressive about that, in any team that turns around in this day and age, in year two of a coaching staff, is the fact that recruiting is happening earlier and earlier. It's harder to rebuild, especially if you get a job late.
Yeah, there's no doubt about it. They've just done a tremendous job of coaching up the players that they inherited. And what Fred Corral, who's moved from Georgia to Missouri, has done with that pitching staff, and let's be honest, the Georgia pitching staff hadn't been great when Fred Corral was there. They'd never really quite pitched. And he comes over to Missouri, boy, and they are pitching with anybody.
Tristan Pompey lifts one to shallow center. And that one's going to drop in front of Nick Horvath. And so a couple on here. Here's what it looks like in the East. You brought up a point while we were off air during break. And off camera, by the way. Florida just plain demoralizes you.
They can take the heart out of a team. I mean, you look at what they did to Vanderbilt at home and what they're doing to Kentucky this weekend. They did it to Missouri. I mean, Missouri wasn't really competitive against them last week. You see that the games, they get a chance to maybe sweep Vanderbilt and certainly win the series. And boy, there's a pretty big gap. Now the Arkansas series was competitive. Arkansas at Florida. But it just feels like there's a pretty big gap between Florida and everybody else right now. Maybe Arkansas withstanding.
I was just thinking, I was like, gosh, I feel like I was there for that Arkansas series. I was. Funny how that works, huh? Ball and two strikes.
Did you do all three of those?
I don't remember, Chris. I don't remember. I think I was only there for two. Well, it was a Saturday, Sunday. I was there for the Saturday.
Well, and Blaine Sunday. Knight beat them on Friday.
Yeah. It was a 1-0 game, I think, right?
And oh, that's right. You did the Saturday game where Florida killed them.
Yes.
and India went off. And the Sunday game was...
You're testing my Bob Carpenter scorebook. To the right side. Keenan Bell tosses to Byrne covering. There's one down. Both runners advance. J.J. Schwartz hit a two-run home run. Nelson Maldonado hit a two-run home run in that Sunday finale. Matt Cronin did not look great that game, if I remember correctly, or the game before.
Yeah,
he's looked like a stud lately, hasn't he?
But, he has. He's fantastic.
Yeah, Cronin gave up the home run to Maldonado that decided it.
Yeah, they won that one 5-4. So they lost one and won another by one run. But, man, you look at the rest of them. Now Tennessee clipped them a game. South Carolina beat them behind a really strong showing from Cody Morris.
When gets to the backstop, it'll bring a run home as Trey Dawson crosses the plate.
Michael Byrne.
I want to go back to something Brady Singer said. You were asking him about pitching this year differently than last year when all the games seemingly were close, and now this offense is giving them a long leash. He said, yeah, sometimes it's hard to keep your focus.
Yeah, well, and that's exactly what I was going to say about Byrne. I mean, you never see him look like this in a safe situation. And I think the mentality, there's no question. I mean, it's a discussion that's been had through the years. It's a different deal for a guy who's used to coming in and pitching in high-leverage situations to come into a 7-1 game like he came in last inning. Enters the game, he'd only given up 3 runs the entire season in 32 innings. Which, if you just turned on the TV and you didn't know his name, you would never guess this is the best closer in the history of Florida. The stuff just doesn't pop. But, man, this dude can execute when it matters. Be interesting to see where he goes in the draft. Mm-hmm. He really projects more as a starter for me, just with the stuff.
Two down. Florida now away from taking the series. They have a chance for a series sweep tomorrow. Here's Cole Cottom. Doubled his last time up. He is 1-for-3.
Chance to do a little more damage. We saw a rocket off the right center field wall his last at bat. Putting together just a really, really good senior campaign. You love it. Just a first-class kid, has an incredible story about the eye surgeries when he was a young man. And one of those kids you really root for.
13 surgeries to correct a congenital myonocytic nervous system in his right eye from 3 months to 7th grade. I think I said that all right.
Yeah, I think that sounded good.
Yeah, no chance. His eye at one point was sewn shut, and to keep him as a youngster from scratching at it, he wore a hockey helmet to sleep in.
It's an incredible story.
Still has no tear duct in his right eye, but he's got a big bat. And he's got a 2-run blast. Cottom's 14th. Climbing the league leaderboard. He saw that one just fine.
Cole caught him. That's called salvage in the day right here, folks. A double off the right center field wall in the bottom of the eighth, and now a homer. Michael Byrne trying to climb the ladder up and in. That's where they want to get him out, but the velo just not there tonight for Michael Byrne, and Cole caught him, turns that one around. And, you know, we second-guessed Nick Mangione yesterday. I'm going to second-guess Kevin O'Sullivan here. Okay, so you bring him in to get him out of the bases loaded jam. You got another game to play tomorrow.
He's thrown 30 pitches.
Why is he throwing the ninth in a 9-2 game? Or, excuse me, a 9-1 game? Why run him back out there for one more when Justin Lewis going tomorrow for Kentucky and Tyler Dyson, who hadn't been pitching great? I mean, it's interesting that he'd run him out there for a second inning. And now all you've done is tick him off because he's given up three runs all year, and now he just gave up equal to that in the ninth.
Do you want me to guess at an answer?
Yeah, go ahead.
The relievers that he put out there earlier, Will Butler, didn't have a propensity to throw a strike. And as dangerous as this Kentucky offense is, you walk a couple guys, you give up a couple bombs, who knows?
You just want, once he's in, you want him to finish the game.
Let's get the win. Let's get the win. Let's get out of here. Tired. I got my head in my sleeve. And you don't expect Michael Byrne to need, you know, 31 pitches. He'll finish it off in Florida with a series victory. 9-4 is the